Yeah, good, Chad. Thank you, mate, and Matt. Good to be here this morning. We've got a long task ahead of us here to call this race, but look, the GT race, the Endurance Championships, a tough one. But the guys were pushing quite hard yesterday in qualifying. Some great lap times, and nice early start for us, mate. I had to set my alarm this morning.
Well, the easiest rule, it's 101 laps long, but there are a few more rules to watch out for. It is a little bit different to the Australian GT Championships. Two compulsory time pit stops, and those pit stop times are based on your driver ranking, so don't worry about the grid spots like we do for the normal GT Championship. The pit window will open at the 30-minute mark, and it's open for 120 minutes. Your top-ranked driver or your pro driver cannot drive for longer than 55% of the race, which should be about 55 laps here today, and you cannot serve your compulsory pit stops, and this is the big one, during safety car periods. Now, Dino, that could be the real game changer here today. If you can get into the pit stop pit lane before the actual safety car boards are deployed, you could essentially go a lap up in this race.
Yeah, correct. So for the drivers that are switched on, if they see a car off the track, they might make the call if they're close to their fuel window. Phillip Island, we didn't have to worry about it because there was no safety car for the whole 101 laps. But if you're due for fuel and the safety car comes out and it's a five-lap safety car, I don't know. You're going to have to come in and obviously do a splash and go just to continue on. But you can be on the winning side of it, you can be on the losing side. So hopefully there's no safety cars, but obviously Phillip Island got through without one. But I doubt it here. But Phillip Island always normally lends itself.
Are you cursing already? Usually we handle that part of it.
There was a few safety cars during the GT race this time on the Sunday morning race here last year. The grid, well, it's a Porsche on pole, and it'll be John Martin starting that car, former Le Mans 24-hour racer. He'll share it with Devashan Panayachi, and wouldn't it be a big thing for Walkinshaw to win this race? They've had a hard week. Conduris and Marshall will be sharing the amazing Superbahn Supermarkets Audi. We'll have father and son combo, the Medici starting in position three, but look at the amazing cars. We'll have Audis, we'll have McLarens, Mercedes the whole way through. Denyer and Morecambe, they're leading the championship after that win at the 101 at Phillip Island. Watch out for Richards and Twig. I mean, come on, Stim Richards is reigning Bathurst champion in this race.
Yeah, that's a good combination down there in 11th position. Lead down the field, Edwards and Bauer, another one to keep an eye on. The Maranello Motorsport team, McMillan and Wood bringing up the 10th row of this race. Back to another father and son combination, the two Rullos from Western Australia. Back to Manolius and Melier starting out of 24.
The Australian Endurance Championship actually has a little bit of a history at this track, and this is interesting. We've got one of the cars off the front row already in the pits. So Marcus Marshall due to start this car from the front row, sharing it this weekend with Theo Conduris. This is a little bit unusual. Let's get down to the pit lane and a very warm welcome for the first time today to Cameron Vanderdungen. Thanks for joining us, Cam.
Yeah, drama before the race start, guys. Broken drive shaft for Marcus Marshall.
That is
unbelievable.
Heartbreaking.
Yeah, yeah. Especially if it was a sprint round, or you just wish it happened yesterday in qualifying. You'd rather start from the back of the grid, but that's something that you're not going to be able to change. Their pit complex is on the other side of the track.
Yeah. And that is unbelievable. I know how excited Marcus Marshall was to get behind the wheel of this car today. To not even make it out for the start is shattering for the Superbahn team.
Well, they're going to head back to the garages, unfortunately. Still getting some heat into the Pirelli tyres. Tell you what, this is the beginning of a very big day on Fox Sports today. You better settle in because it's going to be a long one on the couch. Throw the remote away. It's going to be a big Saturday on the couch with the supercars. And it all kicks off with this race first up. And unfortunately, it's going to be a semi-vacant front row. But it looks like the cars are taking formation. Lights are out on the Lexus RCF safety car. Nathan Antunes is carrying our onboard for this one. Very quick at this racetrack last year. This is Red Flag Gate. Remember that one in the practice session last year?
Yeah, it still haunts me, that one. Quick to remind me about it last year, but keep an eye on him in the number five machine alongside Nathan Morecambe for the start of this race.
The Australian Endurance Championship first appeared at this racetrack in 1990. It was the Nissan Sydney 500, and it featured Group A touring cars. Three drivers from that race back in 1990 are on the grid right now. I'll touch on that a little bit later. I'm going to tease that one, see if you can think about who those three names might be as John Martin leads us onto the front straight. Big field of GTs ready to go for round two of the Australian Endurance Championship. Put 101 laps up on the board. Put on the kettle, settle down. It's Saturday morning at Sydney Motorsport Park and the Red Rooster Sydney Super Sprint. Super Saturday is going to kick off with a very slow start, rolling towards the flag, waiting. Gee, they're all on top of each other. This spells disaster when they're this close. But John Martin lights up the big box of six, and away we go. Swings to the outside. The Aston Martin's got the mumbo to get to the inside of the objective McLaren. And that'll be George Medici going side by side with Warren Luff. Pole tyres are nearly contact. At the exit of turn one, Luff, he wants to argue the point. And they're going to run each other wide through turn two. It's the perfect start for John Martin, though. And it looks so far, Matt, to be clean through the first couple of corners.
Martin got a great start, albeit being on the front row. He got away from these two guys. That's fantastic between the Luff and Medici car. The Aston Martin gets up the second spot now. Everybody's safely through the first couple of corners.
And then Tunis with a big dive to the inside. Got one of the new GT3 Lamborghini Hurricanes at the back of the field as well, but a good clean start to a long race, Dean.
Yeah, I actually was walking through pit lane before the start of the race and saw Luffy and Medici talking to each other. They said, oh, you know, we'll both just push forward, but I think their ideas are a bit different there. They almost touch panels there, but I'm sure everyone will settle down. Looks like a good first clean lap, and George's got some pace here, but again, tyre deck here, they haven't really had much time. They had a 20-minute practice session, two qualifying sessions, and it's not really enough time to get some data on seeing how much tyre wear there actually is. So they're all playing it a bit by ear, but this track does lend itself to being pretty hard on tyres.
Yeah, certainly the numbers that we've seen across yesterday's practice through all different categories were suggesting that it would be like that. It's Craig Baird in the STM Mercedes. Bit of work to do to that car. It found the wall over the right-hand side of our picture yesterday with Scott Taylor at the wheel. First lap of 101 complete, just 100 to go, and it's John Martin in that Porsche off to a cracking start, but Andrew Medici, Matt, has lowered his eyes and he's trying to chase John down.
And they've left the Luff car behind right now. He's clawing onto the back of the Porsche, the Walkinshaw Racing entry, leading out of turn number two now on lap number two, a 131.71 starting lap there for Martin, for a 132.4 for Andrew Medici. They sweep across the top of the access tunnel and the run down to turn number four.
Yeah, I think it's actually George in that car. I did see him getting in there. He's twice my height, so.
So he's 5 foot?
Yeah. Thanks, mate.
That'll come back to haunt me in about 90 laps, I reckon.
But I think some guys, Luffy's probably just driving to a number. And, you know, John Martin's obviously just going out to get a bit of a breather, and then he might sort of bring that pace back a little bit. But probably not much point pushing at this time.
How hard is that, though, when you've seen the guys in front pushing really hard and you've taught yourself to go out there and drive to a number?
Look, I mean, Phillip Island, we probably learned a few things there because we were all pushing each other that hard at the start of that race in the first endurance round. And I was the first to suffer a tyre failure due to the high loading circuit that it is at Phillip Island. And then subsequently there was a few more after me, but I think everyone now is just, you know, tyres obviously are what wins the race, so you do need to look after them, and I think Luffy's well experienced, and he's just cruising along. There's no point challenging at this point in time.
Well, it's not what Dom Storey thinks. Look at this, aggressive from the AMG. He's just going to muscle his way through to the inside, and the Ortex Mercedes. Luff not going out without a fight, though, hangs on to third spot. Good battle in the early stages, still waiting for these Pirelli tyres to come up to temp. Storey gets the inside down at turn four, and that's the end of the story. He's into P3.
That was good. They went off for two or three turns. Lots of respect given from both parties.
Then you realise it's only lap three, don't you?
Exactly. It's the same thing.
Well, Dom's obviously keen to make sure that he catches up to Medici and Martin, who are ripping off a good one or two corners up the road at the moment. So cool to have these new Mercedes fresh out of Germany. Debuted at the 12-hour this year in pit lane. Obviously didn't race the 12-hour, but it was the world's first look. This unbelievable new sports car, Eggleston Motorsport operating that car here this weekend, and Erebus operating the STM Mercedes. That was whipping through a little bit further back, down in P11 at the moment.
Nathan Antunes are on board with, running back there in fifth position aboard the number five Audi. Sweeps onto this long Sir Jack Brabham straight, all about the slipstreams and the run down into turn number one. So we start the end, finish the end of lap number four. Let's head down to pit lane with Cam.
Yeah, 101 laps, and unfortunately Marcus Marshall didn't even get to turn one lap. Tell us what happened.
Yeah, look, basically just warming up the tyres in the car, and as I normally do. I've done it a million times, and unfortunately we had a CV or a drive shaft let go in the car. Unusual for the Audi R8. It's usually a very reliable car, and just one of those things in motor racing where it happens. And unfortunately, we're front row start, but we were looking at a great result, but not to be today.
Thanks, Marshall.
Cheers. Thanks, man.
X1GP driver and Champ Car star, and this battle, Matt, is getting heated.
And Dean, you just pointed out it was only lap three before, and Nathan Antunes is turning up the wick here.
Yeah, they had a little touch here. I don't know if Luffy has got an issue. They had an issue with Phillip Island in the first endurance round with a leaking intercooler, I think, so they were losing boost. But hard to say. We might have to find out in pit lane there if there is an issue or if he's actually just driving to a number. But Nathan was trying to make a move there, and Luffy just covered the door. A little touch. That doesn't come back to haunt him later. But John Martin, obviously, he has the longest pit stop actually out of the whole field, so that could be the reason he is actually pushing away a little bit. So far, it's been some clean racing, so safety cars may not play a part in this race.
But by doing that, if you get a safety car, all that hard work goes, but you're putting more pressure on the Pirelli tyres.
Yeah, correct. So it's a trade-off at some point. There's David Russell making a pass on Clark.
Lamborghini has got some legs in a straight line. V10 versus Turbo 8. And it's the Lambo who takes that position away. We'll see Russell in a Nissan for the next three rounds of the Virgin Australia Supercars Championship. And it's on down here as well. McLaren versus McLaren. And that is Nathan Morecambe, the points leader. And local Sydney boy moving on through. Quite a few of these 650S McLarens out on the field. So disappointing to have that vacant grid spot on the outside of the front row. They really let them wait for that green flag. Must have been an extremely nervous feeling for John Martin waiting for the green to appear.
Look, John's plenty of experience under his belt. So you got to maintain that certain speed as you come to the line. And again, we've had issues with the green flag going early, and then it causes issues further down the track as you approach turn one a lot faster. So it's the same for everyone. Yeah. The starter has the right to wave the green flag when he's ready. But
that was close. That was Antunes nearly making contact with Nathan Morecambe. Antunes' opening lap sprints have been amazing this year. He had one at Clipsal where he passed nearly half the field in a lap.
Yeah, he's a very aggressive and clean little driver, but catches a few guys off guard. And look, that's the best opportunity. The first lap when someone's having a bit of a snoozer.
Oh, whoops.
Had a touch and a spin.
Our visitor, Miguel Molina, DTM race winner.
That would have been Richo, or is it Twiggy?
It's Richo in that car. Richo in the M6. Lap times at the front. They're setting a fast pace right now. 1 minute 28. Fast lap of the race. John Martin, and it's a very warm welcome and good morning to Kylie King in the pits.
Actually with me, Devash and Paddy, actually teammate of John Martin. You'd be pretty impressed with that little start there.
Yeah, it was a great start. You know, John's done exactly what we planned. You know, it's obviously unlucky that the other Audi didn't start. It's never good, but you know, gave us a clean run at the start and holding the Aston off, which is the main thing for now. And you know, that's going to be our biggest challenge for the rest of the race.
Now, we've seen you win Porsche Carrera Cup, but this is a bit new to you, something a little different.
Yeah, I haven't done it before, so we'll see. It's going to be a long race. I think I've got a pretty long stint as well, and you know, it's a hard track on tyres, so I've got to manage tyres, got to manage fuel, but luckily the car's not too bad, but yeah, it's the first race for us with this car and an Enduro, so we'll see how it goes.
Best of luck, and we'll chat to you later.
Thanks for that.
Thanks to Kylie down there in the pits. Really excited about Sindabashan and that car today. Impressive yesterday in practice in Porsche Carrera Cup Australia, but comes with some open wheel experience. He finished on the podium at Singapore a few years ago. He formed the BMW Pacific. He got a top 10 at the Macau Grand Prix, and he's just been slowly moving up through the field.
Yeah, he's definitely been under the radar and surprised me yesterday in his qualifying session in the GT car. So they, Chad and I worked it out yesterday in qualifying with our brain power combined that they were going to be on the front row because it's a bit different the way they work it out here. But look, they're a very strong combination. The only thing that's going to hurt them, obviously, is that long pit stop time. 139 seconds for each stop.
Antunes, very late on the brakes, nearly goes up the back of the objective, McLaren for one, and then had Largo for company in the middle of turn two. That's obviously David Russell in that JBS Lamborghini at the moment. That was tight, but yeah, big pit stop time for the Walkinshaw Porsche.
Yeah, and it's 27 seconds longer per pit stop over the Medici car, so
nice.
That's something you can't make up on track. I'm not sure what Andrew's times were like compared to Devashin's, but we'll see what pans out.
But you raise a good point, though, because qualifying said yesterday of the average time of the two drivers, and that also adds another twist to the mix, because you're going to have two guys that are similarly matched here.
Yeah, correct, and that's the beauty of this championship, obviously. It all comes out in the wash, and the way they give the time penalties, and you obviously get penalties for qualifying on the front row, but you get points for the championship, yeah. So everything adds up, and you've got to weigh all that up. But
Seriously.
And Tunis, this is before the moment that we had at turn two.
That's only a slow part of the track just there, turn one.
Over 200Ks, tipping it in, fifth gear, back end stepping out on a cold morning here in Sydney.
That was the opposite side of the track that was causing all the concern yesterday in the Virgin Australia Supercars Championship, and now they're getting more aggressive on the inside of turn one. Those curbs, they're sharp angled. You really feel that with the steering wheel, don't you?
Yeah, definitely, and with that sort of high loading downforce through turn one, you don't want to be running a wheel over the curbs.
Here he goes.
Oh, that's deep.
Left it late, didn't he?
He's got
one. Oh, no.
And let's rustle through. So two for the price of one down there at turn two.
Lucky did the right thing there. Saw it and turned out, luckily. Luckily, his experience, because that would have been in tears otherwise.
We said he's aggressive. He's in a McLaren for the GT Championship this year, but he's back in familiar colours with an Audi, which he spent the last couple of years in his championship racing. And it's kind of thrown Luff's rhythm out the window. Oh. And Baird wants to have a crack in the new Mercedes. That was a little bit close too. Luff really struggling in the early stages of this race, more than we would have thought so. I really would have assumed that this early morning conditions like this, this cold weather would really suit the turbo cars. But for whatever reason, the objective 650S McLaren's not really coming up to speed yet.
Baird's the big mover here, guys. 13th position, up to 7th, up to 6th now. This is an incredible start for him.
Yeah, look, Craig, again, at Phillip Island, he's well experienced. He's only got a few more notches on the belt than me. But Phillip Island, he came through quite strong as well. And, you know, that is a fast car. You look at Dom and the lap times he's doing right now. He's in P3. So the car's very capable. Obviously, Scotty Taylor's late to motorsport in his career, and he's still learning. So that's why they're a little bit further down. Oh, so late.
All the way to the exit of turn two. And this is what it looked like again from the outside.
I'm pretty sure Luffy saw that one before it was actually going to happen. I reckon he knew what Andrews was going to do, but not ideal. Not the way you want to sort of achieve it. And there was no benefit for Nathan in staying where he was. D Rush just said thank you. Two spots.
So we're about halfway through to the pit stop window, the pit window opening 30 minutes into the race. That will be a chance for the majority of the field, being the pro drivers, to hand the car over to the amateur driver, or at least the driver that doesn't quite have the same ranking as them. Remember, those pro drivers cannot drive more than 55% of this race. So for these two gentlemen on track, Cameron McConville and the number 8 Ferrari, he'll be handing that car over to Adrian Dietz. Nathan Morecambe, he has a very handy co-driver this week, a man who very much impressed us at this track last year. Grant Denyer was on fire.
Yeah, he was great in the wet conditions. I thought that race on Sunday morning was probably one of the best of his career here. It was very tricky conditions. They head down behind the backside, up to the final turn. Here at Sydney Motorsport Park, the battle for 8th and 9th as we're on lap 10. So 1/10 distance of this Australian Endurance Championship 101. To kick off a massive day, the Red Rooster Sydney Super Sprint. Unbelievable weather outside. It's phenomenal that it's sunny conditions compared to what we arrived to on Thursday. We were pretty much underwater, and there's still lots of puddles. If you get off the track, you're going to get bogged.
Yeah, the green stuff's not very grippy when it's been raining as much as it has. And you know, got the chance of the car digging in and tipping over. We saw a Carrera Cup car yesterday roll over. But, John Martin and George Medici out in front there. They got a nice little breather over Dom Story.
He's running lonely at the moment, isn't he? 6 seconds behind Medici and 9 seconds ahead of the rest of the crew. They're wondering if there's anybody on the track.
That front pack, they're turning very fast, 1 minute 28 at the moment. Good second and a half quicker than the battle pack we were checking out earlier of Tunis & Co. A couple of Audis in the mix here. There's Molina with a big donut on the door. A welcome to Australia message. We believe it was Stephen Richards that tagged him down there at turn four.
I'm wondering if we could get Cameron just to go down to McElroy's and just have a chat about the Luff car, just to see if there's anything wrong, or if he's actually driving to a number.
Well, the numbers at the moment don't lie, do they? That car, for whatever reason, after qualifying so well and having definitely one of the best sports car drivers you can put in it, just seems to be a little bit off the pace at the moment. We'll see what their lap times are this time through. They're about to complete lap number 11. On the front straight comes the just cuts McLaren, being chased by the older model Ferrari. So the leader just did a 1:28.4, and Luff a 29.9, so 1.5 seconds off the pace every lap. Oh, McConville's getting racy here, wants that spot. But Morecambe is really good at the exit of one. Doesn't really leave McConville any chance of getting close enough for a move at two.
Yeah, newer generation car versus older generation car, but the older Ferrari there is still a good car. It's no slouch, but Nathan driving really well. He's come a long way in the last couple of rounds, and obviously leading the championship at the moment. I did see Grant Daniel earlier in pit lane, and he did remind me he did win here last year. He had to point that out, and I said, yeah, because he's had more GT wins than me, but I'm taller than him, which is good.
Not many people you can say that about, Cameron.
No. Yeah, jump down with McIlroy Racing, guys. I can tell you, Luffy's just got some balance issues with the car at the moment. Nothing cynical or sinister.
Well, they'll at least have a chance to work on that car, because the pit stop times allow quite a bit of work to happen. They've got nearly 2 minutes in their pit stop to see if they can try and negate that issue. Now, Mullen has caught back onto the rear end of the M6. Now, that's impressive, considering he was facing the wrong way at one point.
Yeah, it's... He's a very seated driver overseas, Molina. So not to say that Richo's not a great driver, but I was speaking to Steve earlier in pit lane as well, and he's saying all the new updates that are getting done overseas as part of the customer program, they get them straight away. So a couple little things that keep coming towards him and improving the car ever so slightly, but he's still smiling as always. Happy he's out there racing.
Oh,
touch here. Sorting the young bloke out.
This will be a good battle between these two.
Yeah. Greg doesn't take too much. If you're trying to cover and someone's faster than you, he'll let you know. So this will be good if we can just stay on these guys for a little bit.
Let's see how bad handles the fast Audi. Bit of a flash of sparks out the back. And Tunis knows that he's under pressure.
Yep.
He runs wide at six, just missed the apex a little bit. This is a brave spot to try and make a move. Stick Bed wants the inside at seven. Oh, and Tunis hangs around the outside. And at turn eight, Bed gets it done on the outside. What a move.
Are you serious? You know better than us, Dino. That's not easy to do.
Nah, look, I think Nathan might have conceded there a little bit. You can. I've raced against Nathan before, and like he is fast, but you can push him and make him sort of back down a little bit or realise that he needs to
chill.
Yeah, just chill. But he's actually better off to sit behind Gray. There's no need to be fighting and trying to drive outside your comfort zone to stay in front of someone at this point in time in the race. So
I mentioned three drivers on the grid today, featured back in that 1990 round of the Australian Endurance Championship. And a very young 20-year-old Craig Baird was one of them. In a BMW.
Sorry, what year was that?
1990.
And he was 20 then. I know his real age now.
Yeah, exactly. Fingers and toes at the ready. The other driver, or one of the other drivers I was mentioning, is about to hop into that Aston Martin.
Andrew, yeah.
Shared the Mobil Sierra with the great Peter Brock that day. They finished third.
Very good.
So opening lap spin from PB himself on that one.
So the Aston Martin there, actually I drove that for the first two rounds of the GT Series last year with Andrew Taplin. Easiest car I've ever actually driven. Out of all the GT cars I've driven, you drive it around and it sort of feels okay. Then you look, nice moment there from Cam. He's trying really hard to get past Nathan here.
Well, Morecambe doing a good job hanging on to this spot at the moment. Kylie's down with their co-driver.
Grant Daniel, what's the verdict on Nathan? Doing not a bad job out there.
Yeah, look, it's sort of a delicate position for us. We're sort of leading the championship, and the car's a little bit of a handful at the moment for him. I can sort of see on the television, and he's been radioing in saying the car kind of, it's got a lot of oversteer, so it feels like it wants to turn around every time he turns the steering wheel, which is pretty unnerving, you know, particularly as you're sort of going into turn one here at about 250 Ks. So I think that might settle down as the car balance comes to him as the race goes on. But, you know, we're sitting in a reasonable position. We probably don't know where we really stand until the second stint is over with. So just looking forward to getting in the car myself.
and a real fan of this format. It gives you real serious time in these race cars, doesn't it?
And these are the coolest cars in the world, man. They are just have a look at them. They're the kind of car you put on your wall as a kid, you know, with a poster. They're super desirable. They're a lot of fun to drive. I've never gone through turn one here in my 20-year career of racing without braking. So it's like eye-wateringly fun. This is a great category. It's going to be an intense race. There's a lot of world-class drivers from all over the globe here, as well as a lot of V8 supercar drivers. So this is going to be a tough 3 hours. Cheers.
Andrew Medici, you're sitting in second place at the moment with your son George, and you've got a shorter pit stop than the car in front. Sitting in a good position at the moment, although a very long race.
Yeah, it is a long race, but yeah, we thought that we had good pace, and I'm pretty happy with where we're sitting. You know, it's good. It's great. You know, it's just a wonderful thing to be able to race with your son, and that's really good. And the car is fantastic. I love this car, and I think we're in there with a real shot this whole race.
You've seen a lot of changes around here, haven't you, having raced here for the very first time when the track opened?
Yeah, exactly. I think somebody pointed out the other day that I did the last endurance race here with Peter Brock in 1990 or 91. So yeah, it's great. It's great to still be competing in this wonderful sport.
Good luck today.
Thank you.
How cool to have Mad Andy's is known. Matt, I know you're a big fan of what he's achieved, particularly in recent years in the Touring Car Masters.
Yeah. He did a great stint there for the Bob and Sharon Middleton team with the Lubrimax Camaro. These days we see him in the Aston Martin. He bought that car out at Sandown last year, and the Stone Brothers had a lot to do with that effort getting this car up off the ground. They're still getting it right, and when they get it right, it's going to be unstoppable.
Yeah, as I was saying before, I actually drove that car in the first two rounds last year, and it broke down in both rounds. But yeah, first hit out, look, it was quick, and easiest car I've ever driven. You know, just produces a lap time without even trying. But interesting what Grant was saying there about the McLaren. It's a little bit unbalanced, a bit oversteery. So clearly the McLarens are struggling at the moment, because Luffy's obviously got a similar sort of issue.
Now the winners in the first round are Phillip Island this year too, guys.
Yeah, which we've seen them jump up in the standings to be on top. Clark Quinn, another one of these McLarens in the field. We probably are used to seeing a little bit higher up, so I just wonder if it's the cold conditions or the fact that the track's probably so different to when they were out here yesterday. But this track will take a fair bit of that Pirelli rubber over 101 laps, and the McLarens could really tune themselves into contention by the end of the race.
Yeah, look, obviously, as you said before, the pit stops are long enough. The mechanics can get under there and change the shock clickers a little bit if it's that small. You know, sometimes it doesn't take much to bring a car back in the window. I wouldn't imagine it's just tyre pressures. Three cars can't get it wrong. But, the three McLarens are all... Their fastest lap times are all within sort of half a second of each other, but they're a long way off the quickest lap time. So they're all struggling with the same issue, it would seem.
So pit window is due to open any second now. We are expecting that the pro drivers who are in these cars at the moment will more than likely try and get one of those stops out of the way. You would hate to stay on track and risk a safety car coming out and losing that advantage. So it'd probably be best to try and get one of those stops done as quickly as possible and get the duration of your amateur driver's stint out of the way.
Yeah, and you sort of work from the end of the race backwards. So you go, okay, a full tank from the end will get me this far. So the first stint will normally be the shorter stint. And getting in the amateur driver or doing your pit stop, one of your pit stops out of the way, limiting the risk of a later safety car ruining any advantage you might have. So Beardo still pushing on here.
Isn't he? He's right on the back here. Right up from 13th position inside the top five. It's David Russell ahead. We'll see in the Pirtek Enduro Cup at Sandown Bathurst and the Gold Coast this year. So he's the mover and shaker in the field.
And, David was quick yesterday in qualifying. He was only 2/10 off John Martin's time in a different session. But The Lambo, the older one, it's the braking package is probably its weakest link. Now that Mercedes has got some awesome brakes, and you probably see that down here as we get to turn two. It's got a little bit more aero as well. The Lambo's a little bit aero deficient, but these two boys will be pushing pretty hard. Both of these guys in the Endurance Championship as well. So
they're competing in both versions of our Endurance Championships this year, whether it be the Pirtek Enduro Cup and the Virgin Australia Supercars Championship, or the Australian Endurance Championship. First started in the early 80s, the CAMS Australian Endurance Championship. It's kind of seen in many different guises over that time as well, hasn't it, Matt?
Comes and goes, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's a few years, disappears, come back.
Yeah, it's good to see Craig back. He's pushing hard.
He wants this spot. Turn six.
No, not there.
I think
Dave sort of, it's again hard to see out of the back of these cars. The mirrors are not wide enough for the rear wing and the rear guards, but I think D-Rust just saw the nose of Craig's car disappear and thought he might leave the door open just in case. He's probably best off now just to let Craig go.
It's a good point you bring up too, because the fans at home, and we've done it, we've been guilty of it in the past, go, how did not see him coming? You can't just lean over and look over your shoulder.
No, and with the seats, the wraparound seats, you know, it's... Some cars have got rear view mirrors, or not mirrors, sorry, cameras. But when a car goes a little bit to one side, you can't see them anymore. And then you look in the side mirror and you're like, well, where are they? So all you can do is really hear the other car sometimes. And you just go, oh, best leave the door open just a little bit, avoid some contact, and live to fight another day. But yeah, Craig's obviously still got some pace here and he needs to get past Dave, but it's not essential.
On turn two. Not going to happen there.
I reckon we're going to see it turn six. It's my prediction.
Right, as this goes on, let's check back down to the pits of Kylie.
I've got Greg Taylor. Nathan Antunes, your teammate, doing okay. You're looking in a good position ahead of these pit stops.
Yeah, so far Nate's done a pretty good job. I think we're in fifth or sixth place at the moment. It's kind of where we expected to be. This part of the race, a long way to go. We're about to get in and do just over an hour, so 45, 46 laps in one stint. So, yeah, looking forward to it. Just want to get in the car.
All right, I'll leave you to it.
Thank you.
That is some strong lead game from Greg Taylor, isn't it?
Yeah, it's bright. You won't miss him.
Part of the Audi customer family these days, Greg, and very much hoping to get a start at next year's Spa 24 Hour, who's a guest of Audi there this year, checking out the action. This is the car that he'll be hopping into in the hands of Nathan Antunes. Doing a good job at the moment chasing these guys down. Hey, boys, the McLaren is getting faster as this race goes on, and I wouldn't be surprised if this is just a full tank sort of scenario. You know, the car can handle completely different when it's full of fuel, and as that fuel is burning off, the McLarens are starting to get a little bit quicker. Maybe that's what was throwing the balance out.
Yeah, potentially. I mean, they're very limited in their practice sessions here. Well, they get one 20-minute session before qualifying yesterday. So typically the professional guys will let the amateur go out in that 20-minute session to give them more laps because they need it. Oh,
here we go.
Angry bunch. Traffic. Traffic from Miles car, is it?
Yep, it's the older model Ellingham and Miles Fastway Audi. And this is going to be trying the patience of the leader. And he sneaks to the inside. You've got to be sure and aggressive when you're moving through the traffic, but that has really brought Medici into play. Medici's going to pass the Porsche in the pits anyway. He doesn't need to do it on the track. But Martin survives the first brush with traffic. Cameron.
I've got Scott Taylor just before he gets in the car. Craig Baird, great drive. Looks like you're going to be in the mix here after this pit stop.
Yeah, fantastic. Craig's done a great job as usual. We didn't qualify as well as what we should have. But, you know, Craig brings the thing to the front, so my job is to have a long stint in the middle, just maintain track position or whatever, and then let Craig finish it off.
It's about to get busy down here. I think I better get out of the way.
Okay, thank you. Cheers.
We've seen Scotty in Porsche GT3 racing and a couple of stints in Carrera Cup in the past couple of years as well.
And really finding a home in this championship. More lap traffic here. It's the Wilson Storage Lamborghini. McMillan in that car at the moment, so they're doing a bit of a reverse strategy. You start with the amateur and then move to putting the pro driver in through the middle of the race. That'll be Dale Wood's brother, Glenn. And John Martin's done a good job here to just build another 5 or 6 car lengths gap back over the Medici Aston Martin.
So it took us 18 laps, 19 laps to start catching the back markers in this one.
Yeah, and they're obviously the AM drivers as well, so we've obviously caught them quicker. But, yeah, as you said there, the different strategy some teams are playing, it just sort of opens yourself to being hurt by a safety car in that situation. But it doesn't look like we're going to get one at this stage, but you should never say never, I suppose.
Long race.
So the lap traffic here doing the right thing. Most of them are moving out of the way, obeying the flags.
Not too many amateur drivers started the race, and I say that with the utmost respect for these guys, but that is the official terminology we use in GT racing, is that they are AM drivers. And all those AM drivers have fallen towards the back of the field here as the pro boys move on through.
They're still doing some nice consistent lap times up the front, John Martin and George Medici, but pretty soon they'll be able to hop out, have a drink, watch their counterpart pedal the car around. We'll have to bring it back in the same position. But between these two guys, obviously, we've got a fairly different pit stop time. So George really doesn't need to push now and get onto the back of John again. And Andrew was quite quick yesterday as well. So
great to have John Martin back. He's been away for the better part of a decade racing in Super League and World Endurance Racing. And a lot of fans watching home state are going, John who? But we know how good this guy is.
Yeah, definitely well experienced. Done a lot more racing than I have. And, you know, in a lot of different categories. So he's well experienced and he's found his feet here in Australia. And, really enjoying that 991.
Matt Solomon in the Erebus AMG SLS putting on some pressure and the pit stop window is open. And here they come, 19 seconds after the window opens. They were not wasting any time, not risking that safety car coming out and losing that advantage. And it actually played into the hands of Luff and Molinar because the window opened, I think, just after Martin and Medici really got across where the pit lane entrance is.
Yeah, look, it's for some situations it will work. That one extra lap's not going to make a huge amount of difference, but I think Luffy would be happy to get out of the car because it's not doing what he wants it to at the moment. But they'll adjust some tyre pressures, have a quick look at the tyre pressures when they come off at the car, throw a full tank of juice in it and sit there for 118 seconds. But here we go. Leader coming in now, John Martin, and Medici follows. Obviously, Medici will leave the pit box about 20 seconds before John Martin's car or Basham.
So we are going to see a change for the lead here, provided nothing goes wrong in this pit stop for either of the two teams. The Eggleston Motorsport AMG is in as well. Now, something's happened over the back of the circuit
the
here.
Ball.
Oh, Matt Solomon was in for a really good stint and gets away with one. And we're going to lose 8 seconds out of that.
Lucky doing a pit stop shortly because those tyres will have a little flat spot on them.
Yep. Okay, Dom Storey, the Kiwi, gets out. He'll be back in the car later in the race. Peter Hackett, AMG driver instructor and a very handy driver in his own right, hopping in that car right now. That was the 911 Porsche.
The pit lane busy here, lap 22. The pit window's just open, 2 minutes now into it. Zantunes jumps out on the number five Audi. Plenty of time here to execute this. The car stationary for well over 2 minutes.
There it is. Hadayachi in. Very relaxed pit stop there. They weren't really rushing, were they? I guess you don't need to when you're in the pits for 2 minutes and 19 seconds. Just take your time, get everything right. This new 911 Type 997 Porsche. New GD3R, what a fantastic car they are. Oh, a little bit awkward, just overrunning the pit box a bit there. McConville in the pits, fuel going in. Adrian Dietz going in. One of three cars that Cam McConville's driving here at Sydney Motorsport Park this weekend. He's collecting the whole set.
A twist with the pit stops too, boys. Refueling can only happen on its own. No tyres can be changed until the end of that. It's been completed.
Yeah, so it's one or the other.
Correct. So you'll see these fuel guys madly get out of the way and then some guys come out with rattle guns and carrying tyres, one on the shoulder, and as quick as they can get those four tyres changed.
It's very much a safety precaution, isn't it?
Yeah, look, and it keeps your staff numbers down as well. You don't need to have a plethora of crew.
So this will put the Morecambe McLaren to the front here, just swinging past. The leaders still very much in the pits, getting those pit stop window, those compulsory pit stop out of the way. So they're going to run this a little bit longer at the first in here.
Compared to the guys ahead, they need 18 seconds less in the pits. As out comes the Lubrimax Aston Martin. Their stop is done.
The other thing, pit lane is quite busy. With that many cars in there, you can get boxed in. So I think the Morecambe car may come in a lap or two.
Well, the other thing is you can't actually take a pit stop when your pit stop buddy is in the pit. So I think that's what's actually happened there.
Correct,
is
yeah.
Probably one of the other Techno McLarens was in there getting serviced or someone else from there. Essentially, imagine what we do in supercars where you share a boom. We don't really share booms in GT3 racing like we do in supercars.
Yeah.
It's a very similar rule. But you're not allowed to stack in this championship like you are in the supercar. So you literally have to stay out of the racetrack.
Yeah, the penalties long enough sitting in pit lane.
So you
definitely
imagine stacking for 2 minutes and 20 seconds just waiting.
And that is, and that is why you can't pit under safety car, because obviously if you're partnered sharing one boom, the first car would get its pit stop done and you'd be sitting there. We've got a battery problem here, have we?
They're going to try and jump start this by the sound of it.
You're not allowed to do that. They're going to put a new battery in the car.
Let's have a listen.
I can hear Cameron,
Good advice, Cam.
Do the old master reboot. Control alt delete. Yeah. Electrical things are working. Are good while they're working, but as soon as you have a problem.
So they are allowed to do this or not allowed to do this?
No, you're not allowed to jump start it. So they're trying to see if that's actually, it might be started, which it doesn't look like it's going to start battery because the lights are on and they're not even dimming, so.
What a shame. Cameron had put in such a good stint in this car. It's the older model Ferrari. We have two in the field. We've got the new 488, but this is the older car. That's still very much in the Maranello Motorsport stable. You'll be trading panels later today in Toyota 86 with him, won't you, Dino?
Yeah. Cam said he had a sore left arm from using a H pattern, so.
Get the rust out of the system.
Front splitter's a little bit damaged on the Rollo carts. Vibrating away there.
Oh, dear.
That doesn't dislodge and go into the front wheels.
They're dragging on the racetrack down there through turn number one. Father and son combination out of Perth. Young Alex racing in the Supercars Dunlop Series this year. Just continues on. It's down to pit lane. Kylie's with John Martin.
John Martin, you were certainly the man of the moment in that early stint. A fantastic start, but I guess you had to make up time, didn't you?
Yeah, no, it was pretty good. Obviously had Medecki chasing us pretty hard, so we actually probably misjudged the track a little bit, so we had quite a lot of rear tyre degradation there through the stint, so I had to try to manage that the whole way through, right from about lap three, so couldn't really push as hard as I would have hoped, but we still ended up coming in the lead with a decent gap, so it's not too bad. It's up to DeVarge and through the middle stint, and then I'll get back in later on.
And your thoughts on Devarshan? He's new to this, but he's a very good racer, isn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. He's done a lot of cup car stuff. He's done a lot of driving. He's done a fair few laps around here, so I have all the confidence in the world in him that he'll do a good job. So, it's up to him now, but, he'll be okay.
2006 Australian Formula Ford champion. Put in a masterful stint at Le Mans. Maybe 2014, I think it was, off the top of my head. I thought we had the Ferrari back on track, and here it is. Okay.
Got it fired up again. They lose too much time.
Adrian Dietz now in the car. It'll take him a little bit of time to get up to speed. Definitely one of our AM drivers in the field, but they've lost a lot of time, even with that long pit stop. I'll tell you another driver who's fallen a long way back here is Warren Luff, who we imagine has handed that car over to Tony Walls. And Cam McConville, obviously back on track, but Tony D'Alberto is another name that we've not really seen pop up yet today. He's driving an Audi today.
Yeah, so they've completed their pit stop. I saw Tony's name on the timing screen at the start of the race, so I'm sure it's Ash in there now, and our timing screens just haven't updated because they've still got all the pro drivers listed. We know DeVarshan's in the Cup car, in the Porsche, but it's still got John Martin's name up there, so we've got a bit of work cut out for us. We've got to remember who's in there now.
You still know that Nathan Morgan's in that car as the Richards entry leaves. Their stop's done.
Twig jumps in.
A former Rennsport winner at this round, or at this track, I should say. One that was Luke Yordan a couple of years ago, 2013. Very talented Carrera Cup racer. But for whatever reason, Twig and Richards haven't seemed to warm to the new M6 yet. It hasn't really worked out for them.
They had the same pit stop time as the Martin Porsche as well, 2 minutes 19.
Long time in the pits.
And speaking of Luke Yulden, as you just touched on, he's sharing accommodation with Tony D'Alberto this weekend and sent me a message this morning saying Tony D'Alberto wanted to get up at 6 this morning to get to the track nice and early, and Luke got into Tony's room at 6:30 to wake him up, and Tony had a few profanities to say and his alarm didn't go off. But
Tony would never do that.
No. So.
Well, Tony's only got a very young son. He's a toddler, isn't he? So
it's 12 months today.
Oh, yeah, well,
He left the commentary box. He said, I can't stay. And I said, I'll do this on my own then.
That's it. He had to jet off from the track last year. Missed out on racing because he was becoming a dad. And we got Mercedes versus Mercedes action here. And this will be the lead pack, essentially. This is looking really good for Peter Hackett, guys. Hackett's already onto the back of the Porsche. The Porsche will be behind Aston Martin after the pit stops have been completed, which it is at the moment. So this is all starting to work out for Cameron. It was an excellent first stint for the man they call Gorgeous George.
Yeah, you reckon it's looking good for Peter Hackett. I think the Medicis are looking good as well. George, great first stint.
Yeah, thanks, mate. It's, I mean, Marcus Marshall helped us by pulling off at the start, but we showed the paces there, stuck with the Porsche. And it's her hard because these things are so aero-dependent. The closer you get, the slower you go. So it's sort of zigzag, back and forward. But pull into pits in the second, and I think Dad's leading of the cars that are pitted, so not too bad.
Mate, great to have two generations of Medicis. We've got a third one here as well. Your daughter's out the back of the garage cheering you on. That must be very special, all in the family.
Yeah, I'd have her here if it wasn't for all the noise. But no, it's something about GT racing. It's all about families, you know, the Quinn family and us. And everyone is just having such a good time, and it's so family-friendly. So, we're loving it. Car's fast. What else can you say?
Good luck, mate.
Thanks, mate.
11th at Phillip Island with his dad, Andrew. The first round of the Australian Endurance Championship. It's the Bowen Edwards Ferrari coming in now. Lap 27.
Which brings us to the third name out of our 1990 Bang. Starters.
The trifecta's complete.
There we go.
Teammates of Dick Johnson that day.
John Bowe, Andrew Medici and Craig Baird. 26 years later, Australian Endurance Championship once again. Fuel out of the way. Now we can start with the rattle guns. So 2014 Bathurst 12-hour winner Peter Edwards will get into the number 88 Ferrari. One with that team, Maranello Motorsport back there, with John Bowe, I might mention. And sign at turn one here.
Peak hour.
Just a squirk out, he's getting caught up behind the Largo Lambo. And this is take the high line. That's how you get it done.
Guys, all tyres are coming up at different rates. Fresh rubber and new drivers hopping into the cars, but still seven cars to do their first pit stop. But a couple of different strategies out there, so some of those guys are still... Oh.
Is this Liam Talbot in the car? Wouldn't it surprise me. He's just won the Spa 24-hour. He's full of confidence. And let's remember, he's an AM-rated driver, essentially. Well, he's just ticked over to Pro 6, but still very much AM-rated in Europe. And he is scything through this pack. Here comes Tony Walls under brakes.
Inside of Roger, two gentlemen drivers doing the sprint round on their, or the sprint championship on their own.
Let's then let the Audi through as well.
So we saw that earlier stint from Warren Luff in that objective McLaren. It looked like there were one or two problems, Cameron.
Yeah, I thought I'd grab Luffy. Dean Canto was wondering whether you had any problems in the car, and the team tells me it was a balance issue. Any more information for us?
Yeah, right from the start, we really struggled with rear balance in the car, and traditionally with this car, usually you struggle with the front, but right from the early on, just really low speed, medium speed, just couldn't sort of carry any lateral grip, and it was a bit of a handful.
You able to tune it up at all throughout this? I mean, is that possible in a pit stop?
Yeah, look, we did a bit of a damper adjustment and some tyre pressures for Tony. So, fingers crossed he can start to sort of push on now. But, look, we know it's going to be a long race. The track's going to improve. And we've got a really good set of tyres for the final stint of the flag. So, fingers crossed we can come back from here.
It's an even longer day when you have an unbalanced car, though, isn't it, Luffy?
Oh, mate, it's a very long day at the office.
Thanks, mate.
Thanks, mate.
Warren Luff down there in the McLaren wetsuit. Looks more at home at a beach, doesn't he, wearing that today? Down the inside goes his co-driver, Tony Walls. Leaves nothing at the exit of turn number two.
Just runs the older model SLS wide, and now the pit stop happens for Morecambe and Denyer on this lap, number 29. So the leader is in. This will hand it over to Clark Quinn now, who's yet to pit as well.
So 1.4 laps, the Medica car is behind Nathan. So by the time we do our pit stop, what have we got for these guys?
So Morecambe's got 2 minutes and one stand time. The leader's 2 minutes 19, so he pitted eight laps later than those guys. Fuel going in.
So at least we get a bit more of an idea shortly on where everyone sort of comes out.
It's the Rollo car coming down. These guys still yet to pit.
Andrew Medici's second times are quite strong, so these guys are going to be tough to beat from here. We see another pit stop, another shorter stop than most. And obviously a very fast car as well, so nice sounding V12. Sounds awesome from inside the cockpit.
We've got 6, 8, 10 and 12 cylinder cars covered for you this weekend. With the Porsche in the field, this is a twin turbo V8.
Look at that, green tyres. Green's going to have some fun on that outlap.
They literally are green tyres.
They were, yeah.
So this puts Clark Quinn to the point. The Sticks, number 37, McLaren. Very talented driver, Clark Quinn, multiple champion of the Australian GT Championship. And sharing this car with Dan Gort. That is a good combo.
Yeah, definitely. I spoke to Dan yesterday, and he's not as comfortable in this car as he was in the Aston with Tony at Phillip Island. But as we heard from Lucky there, the McLarens are obviously just struggling a little bit with oversteer today. So it seemed to be a bit of a common theme. It was the same thing that Grant said about their car. So hopefully a couple of little changes in the pit stop.
Well, let's hear how Dan's feeling right now. He's with Cam.
Well, he's not got his helmet on at the moment. Dan Gaunt looking like you're going to run long in this first stint.
Yeah, we're slightly out of sync with everyone else. You know, we're going to 46, 47 with Clark, and then I'll jump in and obviously go to the end. So, yeah, the alternative strategy, we're on. The other one was obviously the pro to lap 20, get them out, and then to 46. So we're doing something a bit different. We'll see where we end up at the end.
That means a long drive for you coming up. How's the fitness levels at the moment?
Yeah, all good. We did the same at Phillip Island with Tony and the Aston. So, yeah, it's car's hard work around here at the moment. You know, we didn't quite tune it. You know, we didn't have a lot of time in the car yesterday. It was my first time driving the McLaren yesterday, so we didn't have enough time to get on top of it. But we're getting there slowly.
Mate, I was looking over here. Jason Dunstan watching on with his chart there, mate. You're going to get this done on strategy. You think you're pretty good with it?
Why not?
Well, good luck, mate.
Why not?
Well, the numbers are crunching down there, so good to see someone rolling the dice with their strategy, and I guess that's their advantage when you've got someone like Clark Quinn in the car, who, if that's your second rated driver, you're looking like you've got a pretty strong lineup. So they've rolled the dice to go the other way to everyone else.
Yeah, look, I had a few races close with Clark in the sprint championship this year, and he's a tough racer. He's not scared to kick it.
So we are currently 31 laps through, so we're pretty much approaching the one-third distance. Clark Quinn is your race leader at the moment, but they're still to make their first pit stop before he hands that car over to Dan Gaunt. And this is a good chance, Matt, to try and just run through the field a little bit as to the drivers who have stopped. The first of those cars which have stopped is on that screen right now. In the background is the Aston Martin, now with Andrew Medici at the wheel. But they're obviously a lap down, so they're approaching the McLaren to try and unlap themselves at the moment, which could make a fairly big difference.
They'll get that back. Been probably 20 seconds by the time they get back out onto the track. Yeah, maybe 30.
So it'll be the Medici team that essentially take the lead of this race after those pit stops have gone through. Second out of the drivers who have stopped at the moment will be the Taylor and Antunes Audi, the number 5 Audi. And then third on the road after the pit stop cycle works its way through for the first stop should be the Martin and Hadeachi leading Porsche that was leading before the pit stops came through. So it'll be interesting to see exactly where Quinn and Gaunt pop out. The other thing is Gaunt will be on track against a lot of amateur drivers with a good chance to make up whatever amount of time they drop back. Here is car 5, so it'll essentially be second after that field is cleansed through the pit stop cycle.
It's a long way to go for Clark on one set of tyres, though, and his times are a little bit off in the car. I just saw there's some footage then. He's actually moving around a fair bit, so while it might look good on paper, you've got to remember it is a high loading track here and a high degradation, so he might be screaming on the radio in another 5 laps saying maybe we should change strategy here, guys. But
but everyone else is going to do a long stint as well.
Correct, yeah. But Medici Andrew here is just putting down some good numbers as well, lap time wise.
So this will be the battle for second once all the leaders at the front of the field have pitted. So Hadeachi is really warming to this car at the moment.
Isn't he?
That last lap, 29.8. Goodness me, 2.1 seconds quicker that last lap than Greg Taylor. Hadeachi on a charge.
Yeah, so they've got to make up that deficit they have with the pit stop. It's really hurting them.
2 seconds, though, big difference per lap.
Even to Andrew Medici, he's fast as well. So, he'll be able to close that margin, but he'll have to work on it again later on, obviously, when John hops back in. But he's only problem is George was just as quick.
So that was Alex Rullo in the car getting out. Interesting that they didn't stop any earlier because of the damage to that front splitter, but clearly wasn't affecting him too much. He hands the car over to Dad. So another one of our father-son combinations. Only West Australian team on the grid, that Lamborghini being run by Lucas Dumbrell Motorsport this weekend. Patient in the mid part of the corner, Greg Taylor.
Yeah, it's nice and smooth on the wheel. He's obviously had some good coaching, and his lap times are reasonably good too for an amateur driver. So,
class winners though, the Bathurst 12 Hour this year with Antunes and Barton Moy, who was very, very good in Formula 3 back in the days.
That's a good combo.
Very good combo.
Yeah. Greg Taylor's getting faster and faster as an AM driver.
Oh, yeah, you can see Clark there just having to fight the car, wrestle it a little bit.
Andy getting a little bit squirrely out of turn three. So this is the effective leader of the race passing the actual leader of the race to get his lap back. It's an unusual set of circumstances, but this is what's going to happen. We have such long pit stop times. Another thing worth mentioning is we don't have the curb strike rule or track limits rule like we've seen in Carrera Cup and supercars this weekend, or like you've been getting in the 86s.
Andrew's got an issue.
Andrew slowed dramatically.
He went wide, but I don't know if he's maybe just went a little bit wide there around six. But as you said, the curb strike rule, otherwise Andrew Medicki would have seen the yellow flash up on the timing screen there. I got it seven times yesterday.
Yeah, you're the leader of that at the moment. Without putting points on that, you've been the Toyota 86 champion this year.
McConville and I broke the record, apparently. Greg told us we both had 17.
Didn't want to bring it up.
Medicki's starting to struggle with that thing.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on there, whether he's watched his mirrors all of a sudden or if he's actually got something wrong. He did drop a wheel off quite hard there at turn five and had some sparks come underneath. Hopefully he hasn't damaged something.
Liam Talbot. I'm a huge rats on this young man. Here he goes, through another one. Saw his first race in 2011. Went over to the 24 Hours of Nürburgring and said, I'll check this out. Thought, yeah, I wouldn't mind getting involved with this. Decided to try drive a radical. Won. Beat everyone. Decided to take a little forward step into sports car racing, and he's been winning ever since. Also, a bit of a rumour going around that he might be part of that Walkinshaw Porsche squad for next year's 12-hour as well. So that could be a very tasty lineup.
Yeah. Another guy that just snuck up under the radar many years ago. You look and go, this guy's just out there having a bit of fun. All of a sudden, he's getting competitive. Then he starts winning races.
It's an amazing story, the Liam Talbot story. And a very nice guy to have a chat to as well. Very down to earth. And so humble. Literally just says, I do what my engineers say. If they say brake here, I brake there. If they say turn there, I turn there. And then he just goes out there and wins. He makes it sound so easy as he cruises on by the 488 Ferrari.
34 laps into this 101 lap Australian Endurance Championship, the second round, and a bit of work now going on to the Rollo car. They're going to repair that front splitter that's been dragging for pretty much most of this race, boys.
Yeah, obviously had a touch in one of the early laps of the race with another car, and the front splitter hangs out a long way on these cars. It doesn't take much to break it. And you lose that aero, especially for a turn one, it's not ideal, especially if the under tray does come away from the car and then go on your front wheels. It's going to end in tears, so best to take some time if you're already out of the race sort of thing and a little bit off the pace. You may as well fix it properly.
Let's go to Carly.
Nathan Morecambe, Grant Denyer's out there at the moment, and he did say there was a bit of an issue with oversteer, and I can see chatting to you earlier and the boys working on the car, it's an issue.
Yeah, so Grant Denyer's out there now. We swapped over just a couple of laps ago. From the start of the race, the car was pretty settled at start. Once we got the temperature into the tyres, the rear tyres started to go off. But we just got mechanical grip with the rear, a bit oversteer entering the mid-corner. But the boys changed a bit of a setup on the pit stop, which we ended up staying in the pits a little bit longer than we'd like. But for the longer run, when we're out there, it's going to benefit us. We're not going to have that oversteer anymore, so looking forward to hunting down at the end of the race.
Yeah, it must be pretty hairy coming to some of those turns with a bit of an issue there.
Oh, definitely, especially around the mid-corner, speeds around the back, trying to go into the corner quicker to get your speed up with the aero, but it's just so nervous that you're tiptoeing for the entry and focusing more on mid-corner to exit. But turn one's definitely a lot of fun around here, and it's a great corner, great track in Australia. So.
Well, best of luck with the next team.
Thank you.
You can see why he and Chaz Mostert are best friends.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
He's just so chilled out, just like Chaz. Now, in supercars, that would be a penalty.
Yeah, I'm not sure what they do in this category. I thought it would be given as well. But anyway, just watching Grant Denyer's times there when they were talking to Nathan, and he's actually only just off Nathan's quickest lap time that he's done in that car with a full tank. So they might have tuned it up a bit in the pit stop there. Grant just loves driving these cars. Always comes out with a smile. I mean, he's always smiling anyway.
The Rollo car spent 5 minutes and 40 seconds in the pits additional to their stop, so it's going to drop a long way down.
So Andrew's gathered himself up again here, and let's see if he can... it's good to see there's no drama with the car, but he just needs to concentrate, get past Clark.
All right, boys, we're approaching the one-third mark of the Australian Endurance Championship second round. Let's check out the highlights so far of what's been not so much an action-packed race, but very much a clean race. Some frantic moments at the beginning, and unfortunately bad news for the Superbarn Audi right at the get-go.
Didn't even make it out of pit lane. The Marcus Marshall Kondura Superbarn entry left the front row with one car missing as the 911 GT2 got away to a great start here. The Aston Martin muscled his way up to second place, and these guys treated like it was a three-lap dash.
Bit of a scrub between our European visitor, Miguel Molinar, making contact there with Stephen Richardson, facing the wrong way. Did a really good job to pull his car back up from there. Nathan Antunes was sideways down at turn one, and then aggressive at turn two. That was one of the highlights of the race.
Yeah, definitely. He was keen to get past Luffy, but had to make the big dive and just went a bit too late on brakes. But Conville had the back hanging out.
He was pushing hard. A small mistake for Singaporean Australian driver Matt Solomon. Saw him slip off at turn six in the older model Erebus AMG. Then the pit stop window opened, and well, it wasn't exactly rushed for the cars, was it?
No, 22 laps into the books, and the drivers swapped over for the next stint of this race. Some great racing so far, and we're only 35 laps into it.
Aston Martin at the front, at least it will be after the pit stop cycle goes through. So we're hearing some more trouble for the Forge Lamborghini of Peter and Alex Rollo. Peter's just taken this car over. Right in front of Greg Taylor.
Not a good spot on the track, but I reckon he's dropped a wheel off on the turn in, maybe.
It's a view from Taylor.
No,
the car
it's cold tyres, that'll be. I guess he's only just left the pits.
Oh, good job, Greg. Good job. That'd be enough to give Nathan Antunes nightmares, seeing a car sideways in that part of the track again after his
flashbacks.
Miracle job last year of getting through there.
I was having flashbacks too.
Seen a few drivers, and particularly our Asian visitors in Carrera Cup, getting caught out through turn seven, Corporate Hill as we call it. Very difficult corner because it is off camber.
Yeah, off camber. A little bump on the way in. The track surface is really worn out there, and it's the car's okay on the way in. And then when you just ask for a little bit more load on the tyre, it can give way on you. So, these guys, obviously, we've got first on the track, but first of the pit stops behind him a lap down, and Andrew Medici. But I guess Andrew doesn't really need to try and push to get past him. He is faster, but Emilia Lamborghini Huracan.
This is the newer model Lamborghini. Just using the indicator to say, go that way. Nice to let one of the leading cars through.
You never want to give away your next move. I'm from South Australia.
I actually put the indicator on, but then didn't actually get out of it to let him through.
But Padayachi, he's slowly closing the gap to Medici. Hopefully he can get on the back of him by the end of this stint. But again...
Well, this is technically for... Not for position. This is actually the Porsche trying to unlap himself here on the Lamborghini, which is an unusual set of circumstances. Emilia had a spin and got caught up in the gravel trap there yesterday. But this is the first time that we really saw Ryan Emilia make his return here 12 months
exactly
ago.
Right. Did very well that weekend too.
Shared the car with Christopher Meeks, didn't he, the Audi?
I think Emilia, he did. Emilia was part of the GRM team for a couple of seasons.
Was a mechanic or?
Yes, a mechanic, yeah. Lap 38, it continues on. Pit lane is busy, let's head down the cam.
I to grab Alex Rullo. You've had a little bit of drama then. There was a splitter issue, I think, and then your old man's gone and spun it. Tough day in the office.
Yeah, we were having a few car setup issues, and the splitter was flapping around a fair bit, especially on the straights and over the bumps here. So I was having trouble keeping it on the road myself, so I was just trying to bring it back. And obviously with cold tyres, Dad's having a bit of a hard time.
You're not going to give your dad a bit of grief after this, are you?
Nah, it's fine. I know how hard it was to control. Like, it was just losing the rear end to most of the corners, so... he's doing an all right job. At least he's still out there.
It must be a bit special driving with your dad, though.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, though. Debriefs are a bit weird. He argues a lot, but it's good fun.
Thanks, Alex.
No worries.
That will get back.
You will see this. Maybe they've got it on Foxtel Go back home. I've got to say, Alex Rullo, was only 16 years of age now, is he? He is so good at speaking on camera already at such a young age. Hasn't got a bit of chewed about him at all. Like, just really confident in front of the camera, presents himself really well, has a huge future in the sport.
Yeah, definitely. He's got his head switched on. He's not egotistical and quite smooth and relaxed on TV. Obviously, he's mates with Nick Percat, and I'm sure Nick's giving him some guidance. But Lamborghini coming in for its first stop here. And Devashan would probably be happy about that because it's holding him up a little bit.
Exactly right. Youngest ever touring car race winner last year was Alex Rollo. Big career ahead of him. Had to get special permission from his school to come and race in the first race at Clipsal this year. What did we think of that years ago? Probably didn't race.
back in now, whether he's flat spotted those tyres when he had that spin. A little angry gaggle of cars here.
Here we go. Denya wants to go to war here with Tony Bates. Tony debuted in that car at Phillip Island, also drove it at Townsville, and great move. Where was the aero wash then? I just expected that car to check up with understeer, but it just stuck there. Gee, Denya's a good race car driver. He's going to be a game show host. He's as good a race car driver as he's a TV presenter.
Been around a while, Grant. He's sort of been under the radar and popped back up again, but as I said earlier, he's enjoying his time in these cars. He'll know about aero wash behind the Lambo. Matt punches a massive hole in the air, the Lamborghini, with that rear diffuser. So, although Grant looks like he's lining up here for turn six, Roger's a pretty smart driver. He'll lean through.
He's carving his way back to the field, isn't he? So lap 40, pit window still open for another hour and a half or so. We just tick over the 1 hour mark of this race. So far, safety car free.
So that we've gone nearly 250 laps in this championship without a safety car. It's just unbelievable.
Shows you the quality of driving's obviously stepped up a long way, and you know, everyone's a little bit more intelligent about their passes. Great driving by everyone. The amateur drivers have obviously stepped it up, and the professional drivers are guiding them along and using their mirrors a bit more. It was a problem in the past where the gentleman drivers would just turn in regardless of knowing if someone was around them. So great driving by everyone, and you know, the series has really lifted.
It's Tony Bates pushing Roger Largo down into turn number one. Lots of experience in Commodore Cup over the years. Replay coming up. Heading down into turn number one. Lots of textbook moves we've seen down here. Oh, the door's going to slam shut. That's not textbook, though.
What I was saying earlier about people not checking their mirrors, but those Astons are pretty hard to see out of. The mirror is only about an inch wide, and very hard to see something when it's right next to you.
Yeah, that's Tony Quinn, who's still in that Aston Martin. Hasn't handed the car over just yet. Sharing that car, the Darrell Lee Aston Martin this weekend with Hayden Cooper, who was running a Lamborghini earlier in the year. Oh, this is a big battle pack as well. Meadiki onto the back of the BMW. He's now in the hands of Max Twigg, and he's still hanging in there with our race leader, who's about to lap Ashley. That's commitment down the bottom of the hill. Out of the way, Meadiki's coming through. Aggressive stuff.
Lucky Twigg saw him there.
Quinn now to the inside of Ash Lamarty, who's made the move up from Porsche Carrera Cup into the GT Championship, sharing that car with Tony D. Matt Nolte's going to be sharing the commentary box with Tony D for the 86s. Oh, Noon's will be sharing with Tony D this
weekend. The other Nolte.
Yeah. And looking good so far for the media. Now, can he get this back to the pits? Quinn will be seeing that going, I wonder if this is going to be a safety car. Should I come into the pits now? No. Looks like a left rear puncture.
Yeah.
And he should be able to get that back without a safety car. But that is really going to throw the race out of the window for Largo and Russell.
Left rear must be debris or something. Oh, no, he's had contact there. There's a fair amount of tyre rub on the side there, so he might hopefully get a replay. Who was he around at that point in time?
Too sure. On the marbles, rubber, that was a moment. It caught Samadi out as well, so the track is taking a lot of rubber on the outside of turn one, and that was a big slide for the Aston Martin. It's got Taylor here, and the STM Mercedes now falling back behind Denya.
Denya's on the charge here, isn't he, boys?
Yeah.
So is Talbot. Talbot's going to have that squirk out inside the top five before the end of the stint.
So Padayachi now is really closing the gap to Andrew Medeki.
I can hear a V10 gurgling past our commentary box window, so that'll be Roger Largo, who's made it back to the pits. Here he comes. Disappointment. Not putting together a fairly clean race until this point. It's been a race that hasn't had that many casualties, to be honest. But it's not been a kind one for the Lamborghinis today.
Yeah, especially when it's right in the middle of your big chunk out of the side of the tyre there, so contact
definite
with
contact,
someone.
Yeah,
yeah, but when it's in the middle of your pit stop window, to have a tyre failure, it really hurts you.
And the frustrating thing is, they couldn't put Russell back in that car because he would have been completing more than his 55% of the race. So they couldn't use that as another compulsory pit stop.
Right.
So it's going to be a double whammy for them. They'll have to come back in later for another stop here.
So the best thing they can hope for now is a safety car to get that gap back. But Anyway, back to the front. Clark's still got that car sort of doing some great lap times considering the tyre wear. And we're 42 laps in, so I think that's when Dan Gorn said they were going to come in, roundabouts.
Yep, so we're entering the pit stop window. Good memory, Dean, for our race leader. I imagine that's going to be a Quinn family strategy by the looks of things. They're 1 and 2 in the race. Clark and Tony. Oh, a big wiggle there for one of the Audis coming out of turn. Brock 05, as it's known as here. Here's the race leader, still to pit. Has got a minute. It's roughly a minute 30 on the race leader because the race leader is right behind him, at least who will be the race leader after the pit stops happen.
And a 2:10 pit stop.
So there you go, they're going to fall. What's that make it? 40 seconds behind the leader.
Plus coming into pit lane and everything else. So, obviously they'll come out a fair way behind the Medici car.
Yeah, it'll be nearly a minute, really.
We're expecting him in about 2 to 3 laps to come into this car. As we get into that 46 lap mark, get 55% home.
Yeah, could be any time now. Depends how bad the tyre wear is, really. If they feel like they're losing a huge chunk of time, yeah. I'm amazed that Andrew hasn't been able to actually catch up and pass him. I know Clark's obviously a very talented driver. He's doing a really good job at pedalling that car as we check out his dad in the Darrell Lee Aston, one of the 2 Astons in the field. This will be the one that you used to drive with Taplin, I think.
No, that's the newer one.
The newer one.
The one that the Medici's got own is the one that I drove, so.
Still doing a nice job on the track with the V12 natural aspirated motor. Tony Quinn following his son around, but 46 seconds down the road. And then McMillan also doing this strategy, and then it's going to be, here he is, right on cue, it's going to be Glenn Wood, who will double stint in the Interloy 48 Lambo all the way to the checkered flag.
Both Quinn and Walls last year, both in McLaren, spun in the wet across the top of the tunnel there and hit the wall quite hard on the right-hand side there.
So yeah. Bates looking for the spot in the number one car.
So the gap now between Medici and Padayachi is 8 seconds. Really doing a great job there, Padayachi. So if he can get past Medici and actually pull away before the last stop, he only really has to sort of get a 20-second gain over Andrew to sort of negate that last pit stop. But George was obviously matching the times of John Martin earlier, so it's sort of a battle between those two cars, I think, once we have the second pit stop and get towards the final laps of the race.
There's Quinn.
Really close now. It was Mark Griffith in the Hog's Breath AMG SLS, the older model Merc, getting out of the way.
We saw him in an Aussie racing car earlier this year, didn't we?
Had a proper barbecue down
there. He did.
Island. Now, will Quinn come in this lap? Is he going to go for another one? Fourth in the race at the moment is the McPherson and Shields Porsche, and Brad Shields will be double stinting to the end of this race as well by the look of it, as Clark Quinn is going around front of the lap. So they are the last car essentially on the lead lap at the moment, McPherson and Shields, but they're not far away from dropping off said lead lap. And here we go, Andrew Medici has unlapped himself, so he's now ahead on the road of the Sticks McLaren. Cam, we're not too far away from this McLaren coming into the pits, you'd have to say.
You say that, but I've just jumped in with the team, and they're going to try and run into lap 48 at the moment. They've got more fuel capacity than the Aston in the McLaren. So whilst Clark Quinn's still happy and they're monitoring the lap times all around it, watch for Clark Quinn to just push on a little bit longer and finish his day with probably 48 laps under his belt.
All right, it's a 130-litre fuel tank that they have in that Sticks McLaren, the 650S, which makes it about 20 litres roughly bigger the Virgin Australia supercar fuel tank. Getting a pretty good run on fuel mileage here. 1 hour and 10 minutes into this race and still no sign of coming into the pits.
Yeah, the other thing is obviously we use the E85 in the supercar, so you burn a lot more to get the same sort of horsepower. Whereas these guys run an L fuel, which is only about $6.50 a litre, I think.
Cheap,
yep.
John Martin has handed this car over to Devarshan Padayachi, the Walkinshaw GT3.
It's driving very well.
Weekend. Yeah, looking smooth. Check out the lap times this time by Matt. So, Matt Andy just turned a 106.5.
He did do some passing on that lap.
Yeah. And it's a 105.3. Turning that into a 130.2. So, 1.4 seconds quicker on that lap. And 1.5 seconds back, is it? Or a bit further back at the stage? Hard to tell as he's officially off the lead lap. His tweak has a little bit of a moment down there in turn two. It can be difficult to tell the actual distance between the cars because once they go down the lap, the timing screen says down one lap instead of the actual time on the road. So it's difficult to know the difference at the moment between Medici and Martin.
Yeah, until everyone does a pit stop and we get everyone on the same sort of lap at the moment. It's got the leader as Clark, but officially he hasn't done a pit stop. So the first of the pit stop cars is the Medici car. On track, he's 5.7 seconds back is Padayachi. And then it's saying 33 seconds to Taylor. So they've got good margin over the Taylor Antunes car.
Just clearing past the Fastway Courier's entry, the Audi of Ellingham, back in the field. This is Padayachi.
So he needs to clear these guys as quick as he can. Every second is crucial.
Absolutely. That's right on board.
You can see the blue light flashing on the dash here. He's madly pressing that button to try and flash the lights. Get out of my way. It should be blue flags, but it's all right. He'll get on the inside here. Get on the gas, buddy. Go, go, go. One car down, he'll get the BM as well, I reckon, by the end of the... Oh, turbo power versus naturally aspirated.
This is a good battle, Padayachi versus Twig.
Yeah, good job, Max, letting him through, not racing him for position. So didn't hurt him too much there on the lap times there for Padayachi. Still quicker than, still quicker than Medici on that lap, so just keep chipping away at it.
Well, that was Medici's first flying lap without traffic because he had a car in front of him the past two laps.
Ooh. Oh! Right, talk us through this, Dean. We go through turn three, you disappear over the hill. It's quite steep down here.
Yeah, good part of the track, over the little hill there. Used to be bumpy, not anymore. They ground it down into turn four. Back of gear, quite a lot of understeer here. Can't use all the track because you've got to get back across to the right for turn five. Don't use too much of the exit here. Quite bumpy on that bit of concrete.
Catching the older model Porsche as well.
Yeah.
Quickly on the
He's pushing hard, Padayachi. Wow. Trying to close that gap. Adjusted the bias there. So he had a little rear lock there as the weight's coming off. And the tyres are changing in quality. So he's just gone a bit more front bias to stop that rear lock. And it's just calmed down, smooth it out a little bit, out of turn eight. Up to one of the best sections of track. Quinny into the pits.
Tony Quinn in. The patriarch of the Quinn family will hand car number seven over to young Hayden Cooper. Interesting to see how Hayden goes in his what will essentially be a double stint for Hayden all the way to the finish line. On the Queensland Formula Ford title did Hayden back in 2011. Flashing those lights, he's coming on through. Andrew McPherson in the older Porsche is going to be first on the hit list here. Turn two will be the spot for it. Under brakes.
That's good.
Good move from Dervishan Padayachi.
Still yet to pit the iMac Porsche, so he goes down a lap.
Yep, we've got Clark in front of Dervishan here, and I reckon this is the lap that Clark's coming in, 47, 48 they said. So Padayachi again, he is lucky with the traffic there, didn't hold him up. Head down now, he's just got to keep chipping away. Move up towards Medici there. Clark would be happy to get out of that thing now. It was a hard stint, long stint.
Well, it depends, because if they're sharing a pit bay with his dad, he won't actually be able to come in on his lap.
Yeah, correct.
That's hypothetical.
Hypothetical?
Yeah. I don't know if they actually are pit lane buddies, but they are teammates, so it makes sense.
Tony's at a minute 40 in pit lane, so I reckon he'd be leaving shortly by the time Clark gets there.
Should be okay. That Quinn Porsche, Quinn Aston still has a little bit of time left in the pits here, and is that going to be enough for Clark Quinn to have to do another lap? Let's find out. Does he come in on this lap? Aha, there it is. So the Aston Martin is leaving, which opens up the pit bay, but Clark goes around anyway. So Clark Quinn is going to go for one more lap here.
You're running on vapors. I hope their fuel calculations are correct.
The thing is going to be fresh out of gas by the time he gets back into the pits. McPherson in that Porsche is in. So that means that Clark Quinn is the last car to pit. Excellent fuel mileage. He's only got half the race done. If they could get home on a one-stop strategy legally, they'd actually be able to pull that off just about.
Yeah.
With a safety car, they'd do it easily.
In time, Alex Rullo's come back into the pits as well, the Lamborghini. So still we've got that car right. On board Padayachi.
Going to hurt Padayachi a little bit just to make cap to Medici. But Clark, expect him to be in at the end of this lap. 48 laps on the set of Pirellis around Eastern Creek. It's pretty impressive.
There's the iMac Porsche going in. Shields and McPherson sharing that car once again. They'll be confused. They do put the fuel in the front of that Porsche. Rear engine car, of course. They're getting ready.
With the fuel rig.
The fuel rig. There's fuel pouring out the top of this. Cam.
Yeah, guys, I'll tell you, I'm standing underneath at the moment. Just copped a shower down here. This is a big drama for that team because they're about to refuel and change over for Dan Gaunt.
That looked like pressure in the fuel rig, actually. So it's not venting or something, and it's probably filled up with a bit of pressure and pumped the fuel out the top.
Don't go standing next to any open flames anytime soon, Cam. Because that looks to be quite the dilemma down there. Dropped a lot of that racing fuel all over the pit lane apron, and as a result, he's having to go around again. Oh, no. How much fuel is in this thing? What a thing to happen right before your pit stop. So Clark Quinn has to stay on the racetrack with the drama going on in the pits, and he would have to be getting short on fuel now.
Yeah, that lap there just hurt Padayachi a little bit. He lost a second to Medici, but now he's got some clear air in front of him. And Clark is the only car on track that hasn't done a stop yet, so hopefully doesn't stop this lap.
They're having to back it off, I reckon.
Yeah, I reckon he's conserving.
Oh, no.
The joys of motorsport. I've seen it over the years. Fuel rigs are always the weak link. You know, something so small can cause an issue, but...
Camera's on the spot, wasn't he? As to where our Fox Sports cameras capture the action. And the drama down there in the pits. What a shame. Clark Quinn having to coast back to the pits now.
It's weird because in the days, it used to be what they call a dead man lever on there. I know that because I used to hold that lever down every now and then during a pit stop, and that would free flow the fuel down. That didn't look like it was up at all.
Yeah.
To put the pressure on
it's
it.
It's strange. That was coming at the top out of the vent. So yeah. They would have just refilled that fuel rig because obviously they've done Tony's pit stop. Looks like they're all good to go. So maybe the guy...
See, that's the lever. See the guy in the background? He's holding the black lever at the top.
Yeah.
Cam.
Yeah, guys, I'm on the spot down here at the moment. They are compromised on fuel. You've picked it. They've had to back off at the moment, but everything's fixed. The problem they had, though, they didn't know what the problem was, and they had to actually fix it before they could pull him in to put the fuel in.
He's coming out.
Have they got enough fuel back into the rig? Because he's on his way to it right now.
Yeah, they're all covered, mate. They are well and truly covered here. They've lost a lot of time, though. Dan Gaunt out on the apron, ready to jump in.
What a shame. A very slow in lap for Clark Quinn as a result of having to do the extra lap essentially without any fuel. They left themselves with no flexibility. It would have worked beautifully had the issue not happened with the fuel rig. And this could be enough to take them out of contention. Well, not out of contention, though. Just probably just need a safety car to really close that gap back up.
Yeah, look, the fuel hoses now. Anytime you have a problem, it's not ideal, but they minimise it. Thankfully, it didn't happen in the pit stop. So he's lost less than what he could have, but Clark getting out there to help Dan get back in.
So the guy on the left-hand side pumping the fuel in. The guy on the opposite side is holding what's called the vent hose. Halfway home this race, boys.
Yeah, but this will eventually put this car in the lead next time by. Hasn't been the lead yet. He's been madly circulating to try and get this race lead finally in their control. They've been kind of the race leader since that first pit stop opened up, but they needed officially to wait for the Quinn McLaren to come in. And 26 years after he first raced in the Australian Endurance Championship here and shared a car with Peter Brock, Andrew Medici is leading at Eastern Creek. How about that? 26 years in the making.
He's doing some good times now. Andrew settled down. Padayachi just took 7/10 out of him on that lap.
So it's the Aston Martin leading the 911 Porsche, chasing in second position. So Andrew Medici versus Dubisham Padayachi on the track, first and second. And that gap, we'll get to that shortly, but it's put the Vortex Eggleston Motorsport Mercedes into third. And that'll be ahead of Liam Talbot. So it's Medici, Padayachi. Talbot's actually just jumped ahead of them on that lap. Talbot is ripping through this field. He's up to third now. Hackett back down into P4, essentially. Emilia and Manolius. Manolius is surely in that car now. They've served their pit stop in the Huracan that we can see through the windscreen. but this is the guy I'm talking about who's on a charge.
Not bad for the older model car. Like, that is, it's got some age on it. And,
he's just so aggressive. He just goes for it.
Well, everybody's been used to overseas. They race a lot harder than what we do over here and not scared to rub panels. So Liam's obviously having some fun out there. The car's working well. And, you know, if you've got the pace, use it.
That car started from 15th position on the grid. Pitted two laps later than the guys ahead.
That's their pit stop time as well, so they'll be coming in at the
1:43.
Okay. That helps. It's at the lower end of the scale. Quinn, Clark, Quinn Dan out Gaunt. Of that car. Dan Gaunt in the car now. And
just left pit lane, so cold tyres. And obviously, they've still got a pit stop to serve, but I'd imagine they they wouldn't need much fuel because they've only got to go to the end. It'll just be to serve their pit stop time, and they'll throw tyres on it probably as well in that last stop. So
that should be Giminoli's now in car number 29, the Lamborghini at the front of this pack. We ride on board with Greg Taylor. That's the Lambo. Beautiful piece of work. We've got to see a one-make series for those Super Trofeo in KL last year. Oh, big moment for the Ferrari in turn one. A huge wiggle and a good save. Adrian Dietz gathers that one back up. Cameron, that was a close call. Who have you got the pits?
Yeah, I got Clark Quinn. I'll have a look at the replays at the moment, though, guys, with that big moment down to turn one with the Ferrari. But whilst we're having a look at that, I've got Clark Quinn, mate. You rolled the dice on strategy with fuel, and unfortunately, some dramas down here in the pit stop.
Yeah, there's a few things going on. We actually ran out of fuel on that last lap, so but you know, the car's not handling quite right, and we've got a clutch issue, and we've got a few issues going on. But Dan's in the car now. He's a solid driver. He'll bring that car home, and hopefully, we'll salvage some points for the weekend. But we'll see how the race. We're not even halfway, I don't think. So, just a long way to go.
Thanks, mate.
Thanks, guys.
A bit of a moment for Scott Taylor. Sorry, Cam, it was nice work down there with Clark Quinn, but Taylor had a big wiggle through turn one just now. Here it comes again. Now, this will be the moment for the Ferrari.
Oh, a little bit wide.
Did he get assistance?
No.
I thought it was two cars there. The red and white confused me.
He's got a little bit wide. Oh, no, he's had a moment there. Just had a wiggle all the way through.
Oh, look at it. Look at the rim popping out of the Pirelli tyre on the right rear. Greg Taylor thinking, please don't go around. He's already had one guy lose it in front of him today. He's got the front row seat for some fairly hairy action today, Greg Taylor. Did a good job missing Adrian Dietz there and swinging through up the inside towards turn two.
So Padayachi's got Medici in his sights. Obviously, those guys have got a nice buffer to Liam Talbot in third. It's 40 seconds back to third. But again, we've still got one more pit stop to play out. We could have a safety car. And the last pit stops will, you know, make it a little bit more apparent what's going to happen.
If there was a safety car right now, and I know you can't pit during a safety car period, but ideally you'd like to try and pit before one. So if you saw a car slip off, you'd dive into the pit lane. But it would be too early to put the pro guys back in at this stage because they'd eventually end up doing more than 55%. But it would really help someone like Clark Quinn, who's essentially handed that car over to Dan Gaunt, the pro, and they know that they can get home on fuel and tyres from here because they've already done a stint like this. So if anyone was to slip off the track, you'd just get that car into the pit straight away, serve the second stop, you're good to go all the way to the finish then. Yeah. Everyone else will still have a pit stop to make.
You'd definitely roll the dice in that situation. Obviously, the strategist will be working pretty hard to count back how many laps in the earliest possible time they can get the second driver back in, or the first driver, whoever you want to call it. But, that's...
Taylor Hart.
It's a very big if when the safety car may fall. But Taylor's driving really hard.
It's been a good effort. I mean, Peter Hackett's a very talented GT driver and knows his way around an AMG. And he just waltzed on by there at the last corner.
Yeah, a lot of these guys were testing here a couple of weeks ago, so probably shows who has... Oh, Talbot, again, aggressive on the inside of... Is it Wood in the car yet, or...?
Should be by now. He should be good for a double stint to the end at this stage, Glenn Wood at the 48.
Really impressed by that old car.
Talbot's been the one-way highlight reel. Here's the replay of Hackett getting past. Just
one way back, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And did it nicely.
Something's not right with that 63 at the moment, surely. I mean, Peter Hackett's a very good driver. And
he sort of missed missed the apex there.
Taylor was more aggressive over that curb on the left-hand side than what the Mercedes was. Yeah, it would have helped him.
Clearly the car owner. He's got no mechanical sympathy.
Hayden Cooper in the Aston Martin. And they're about to go a lap down here, I think.
Yes, less than a second. First and second on the track right now. Medici Patiarchi, we ride on board with. Lap 55.
Only one car between first and second on track.
So they've already lost the lead lap, the Aston. Safety car now, and if it was to happen and they could pit, they'd be good to get home to the flag. They know that their driver in that car can drive the whole way to the flag now because they would only be doing 55% at worst. So a safety car anywhere between now and the next safety car window, or essentially the next drivers hopping in, would really help.
Yeah, I think for obviously for the Martin crew, Martin Patiarchi car, it's the earliest possible time they can get John back in. He was a little bit quicker than Patiarchi, the better. But at the moment, Andrew's pushing hard.
So the leader just running wide for a moment. A chance here for the second Aston on the road to unlap itself, which would be very important if the safety car was to come out right now. Try and get that lap back at all costs, even if it means putting pressure on the race leader. And Sebastian Patiarchi closing in for the kill.
Yeah, a bit of a stalemate now between Medici and Patiarchi, both doing the same sort of lap time. So, again, after this next pit stop, they both pit at the same time the first time. So, they're on the same strategy. But Medici's obviously got that 27-second advantage in the pit stop.
Yeah, that helps.
Yeah.
So Patiarchi needs to catch him, pass him, gap him.
Yeah, so he's done a great job to close that gap already. But for it to sort of play out for them, he actually needs to get past Medici and pull at least, you know, a couple of second gap before he hands over to John Martin.
Well, there's the proof down the bottom. The last four laps, he's been gaining and gaining, even if it was just slightly on that last lap. One of the Lamborghinis is coming into the pits, by the way, being the new Huracan. Still telling us that Ryan Milieu is in that car at the moment, having served a pit stop, which is unusual, but either way.
So, yeah, Milieu would have done his 55% now, so they'll put Jim until the end now, I guess.
Strange that you would two-stop it like that, but it works, I guess.
As I said, there's one strategy that sort of works and a couple of alternate ones that could work.
Well, they're the only team that went pro-pro-am. Everyone else has gone pro-am-pro or am-pro-pro, if that makes any sense. The beauty of the Australian GT Championship is we try and confuse everyone. Look at that car scraping. Now, listen to the Porsche down here at Turn 2 for a second. Just listen to the Porsche. It really makes an unusual noise. And, of course, it doesn't do it that time through. It's been making like it's got that Sierra turbo flutter about it, the Porsche down there at Turn 2.
More on board.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We hear it earlier. Chasing down Medici. Inside 1 second difference, there or thereabouts, 0.9 of a second. And Liam Talbot trying to close in on both of them at the moment. But Talbot's going to have a huge pit stop advantage, isn't he, Matt? 1 minute 43 compared to 2 minutes 18 or whatever it was, 2 minutes 19 for the Porsche.
Those guys are in the box seat right now.
They're pretty good. They've only got a 9 second advantage on the Medici's. I'm still liking the Medici's for the win here today.
Vintage Andrew Medici driving right now, as the boys like. This is a guy with 35 plus years experience. Showing the way around this Sydney Motorsport Park on lap 57. Hayden Cooper car splitting these two at the moment. That's the number six Audi across the top. Down to turn number four. On the charge.
Medici and Patiarchi on that last lap both did a 30.8, 1 minute 30.8. So they're still pushing really hard. It's great lap times. And pretty soon we'll see them peel in for another pit stop and hand it over to the other driver.
Now, Liam Talbot's rating here is Pro 6. It was Jake Foraker who's a Pro 5. So they're another team that could make the most of a safety car period now. They'd be actually able to serve that pit stop and get home to the flag because Talbot can do more than 55% of the race.
Yeah.
So that would actually benefit massively from the safety car.
Yeah, so while he's quick, they can keep him in there and just keep going until he's out of fuel.
We mentioned Jake Foraker. Kylie's found him in the pits.
Liam's out there doing well. You did a great stint too. Well positioned, you two.
Yeah, we're looking good at the moment. Put in a pretty hard stint at the start. Had to push quite hard to catch up to the guys in front. Dropped back quite a bit. Well, I caught up to them and then used my tyres quite a bit. So dropped back a little bit there. Liam jumped in and he's doing a really good job at the moment. He's picking off guys, getting up there. So we're looking pretty good at the moment.
Our viewers may not know enough about you two. Tell us a little bit about your background, but Formula Ford, but new to this category.
Yeah, exactly. It's only my second race in the GT category. So did a bit of Formula Ford, Formula 3. Drove a GT car once last year, which is Isle of Magic, and then Phillip Island a few months ago was our first crack at GT, so pretty happy with this at the moment.
Yeah, and when are you looking to get back in, do you think?
Roughly around the lap 70 mark, I think we'll jump back in and try and bring it home.
Well, good luck.
Thanks.
Ryan Miller, just out of the car, handed over to Jim Manolius, mate, good first stint, doubled it at the start.
Yeah, that was our plan from the start. Try and get the car in a nice position to put Jim into the end. We've been struggling with the car, a brand new car in Australia, so we're struggling in qualifying. We're struggling in the first stint, and then the boys made a demon tweak, and the car is a whole new car. So really, this race we're learning really fast, really. So we're just going to keep chipping away, and hopefully we can get a good result today.
You much prefer to be behind the wheel than on the spanners, I'd imagine?
Oh, definitely. I've been on the spanners for over 13 years, and to be in the car, it's been a dream, really. So, yeah, it's been good.
Thanks, Ryan.
No worries, thanks.
Ryan Bailey looks like he's cracked a sweat after driving the number 29 GT3 Huracan, the later model Lamborghini. Hands it over to the car owner. And Trofeo Motorsport are going to be importing these cars into the country, and already I hear that there's going to be a second one running in the championship as of next season, which is exciting news.
Yeah, it is. It's a great car, great for the championship, and they'll run the customer support program here in Australia. They're in contact with the factory whenever they need to be. And Liam Talbot there. Jake Foraker, I'm not sure if he's actually driven today because his hair was pristine, but Twiggy's obviously...
He's gone to the Rick Kelly School of Helmet Hair. This is an amazing replay of the front end of Twiggy's McLaren.
Wonder if that had something to do with the Largo tyre earlier.
Yeah, right. Good call.
Right to left.
Detective Canto on the scene.
Not that I've ever hit anyone on track.
No.
Wouldn't know what that's about.
Speaking from experience, that's why you know it happened. Greg Taylor, we go on board with him right now. 10 years since your first supercar win, Dino.
At
Perth, 06, you got that?
Yeah. Going back a long way, but yeah, that was my first one. It was one of those reverse grid races, and I was sort of mid-pack most of that year with where the car was, so started mid-pack, but I had the slower guys in front of me, and right at the last lap, I was behind Paul Radicici. The second last lap, he had a bit of a fuel pressure issue, and I had a nudge with him over the back of the circuit. Then the last lap, last corner, we both accelerated out and his car died and I've swerved to miss him. And it looked like I turned him round and I didn't, because you can't catch someone on the way out of a corner that quick. But served him to the inside and crossed the line. I was like, do I celebrate? Do I not celebrate? But that was technically my first win. Had more with that. I've got a surfboard with Davey Reynolds. But like you said, 10 years since my first one.
Looking forward to a good Pertec Enduro Cup, though, this year.
Yeah, mate. Got to get used to signing the number one on autographs and things like that.
You wearing that number one, man.
Yeah, but get to stay in the same colours, so I won't pull up under the wrong pit boom. I know to look for that Bottle-O again. It's been a fair few years serving in those colours.
Is that secretly why you wanted to stay in that car? Just the pit boom?
The car is mine, and Mark wanted to be with me, so...
It's the perks that come with driving for the Bottle-O.
Exactly, yeah.
That's what he wanted. Now, this battle on track, we saw Clark Quinn unlap himself there. So, Quinn's doing a good job at getting out of Dodge down there at the moment. That's Tony Bates in the Audi, and that will be for position. As it should be here with the Quinn car, which is now being driven by Hayden Cooper, and now Dan Gaunt in the 650S car, also fighting away with Tony Bates.
That's 8, 9, 10th. You're watching right now through turn 4 and 5, lap 61. 1 hour, 33 minutes. This Australian Endurance Championship race.
So Dan's done the quickest time now for that car, so he's obviously got his head around a little bit more than what Clark did, but they might have done some changes in the pit stop. But Liam Talbot, he's taken 7 seconds out of the guys in front over the last sort of three or four laps. So if he's going to, what, 72, I think Jake said?
Yeah. Yeah.
And their pit stop is a lot less.
Here's the confirmation of those numbers. He is flying. I mean, he's catching a newer model Porsche being driven by a Carrera Cup driver in an older model Audi. He's only got limited experience, although coming off the back of winning 24 Hours of Spa in the AM category, which is pretty impressive. This is a huge drive from Liam Talbot.
You need to get the gap underneath 36 seconds, and it's now 34.
Okay.
So he keeps chewing away at this.
Here we go, battle for the lead. Side by side down the front straight.
V12 versus 6.
Twice the cylinders has the power in a straight line.
And it shows.
Always wins.
Andrew Medici hangs on down there, but under brakes maybe could be the time for Vashon Padayachi. Padayachi needs to make this pass, because he needs to try and gap. Oh, the Aston,
Andrew.
He slides it through turn two.
Watching his mirrors a little bit.
They're catching Tony Bates. They'll be lapping Tony here. Good battle for the lead. Well, over the halfway point, approaching the two-thirds distance mark in this race. It's been a very entertaining journey so far. The battle for the lead is on right now. Liam Talbot in third. Fairly even lap times across the front three, but definitely second and third. Padayachi and Talbot quicker on that last lap. Glenn Wood's coming into the pits, by the way, and that is to serve, I imagine, the second of their pit stops, unless it is unscheduled, as this battle continues frantically down at turn eight. 10 years since Doohan and Creville got into each other down there in the old 500cc Repsol Hondas. This track with so much history. 20 years, I should say. That was 1996.
I think Padayachi here just needs to put some pressure on Andrew. Because Andrew is watching his mirrors a little bit. He hasn't got the straight line speed that the Aston has, but he's definitely got the car's performing a little bit better than the Aston around the tighter stuff. Look at that thing just pull away from him. That'd be frustrating. That's the whole balance of performance for this category. But into turn one now, Padayachi. Again, Tony Bates in front of them. See what happens into turn two here. Andrew's gone deep on the brakes.
Oh, he's going to run up all the way to the edge of the track at two. Padayachi needs to get this move done and needs to gap him. All the meanwhile, they're getting caught lap after lap by Liam Talbot. Talbot's pit stop time is much shorter than the Porsche. I just wonder if it's worth keeping Talbot in that car given the form he's in.
Yeah,
he's
well,
actually rated less than the other driver, so he technically can do it, although, sure, that's... No, here we go, under the inside at turn six, the Lubrimax Aston goes through. I'm sure Foraker probably wants to get back in and actually have a steer of that car at some point, but yeah, it'll be an interesting strategy.
You want to win and get the best possible result, so if one driver is more comfortable on the day and is faster, you're better off to leave them in as long as you can, so... If I was them, I would go to as long as the fuel tank is allowing them to in this stint, leaving Liam in, punching out some great lap times, and yeah, that last pit stop's really going to help them with that less penalty.
It's unusual that the faster driver is the driver that has the lower rating, but that is the case between Jake Foraker, who's still very much a rookie in this category.
Well, let's get down to pit lane, because we've got some very, very big news, and it concerns our race leader, Cam.
Yeah, guys, Andrew Medici has just incurred a 5-second post-race penalty for exceeding the track limits.
Okay.
Wow. Well,
we talked earlier that we don't have the information popping up on our timing screen as to who is exceeding track limits, so this is very much race control's discretion.
So they might be using judge of fact. Oh, he's gone deep into two again. Yeah, so they might be using the judge of fact on that corner, or I'm guessing it's turn five.
Or turn eight on the exit.
Turn eight, yeah, I haven't seen too many running wide there, but they're the two turns where they sort of, you know, give you a penalty. But he would have got a warning over the radio first, so they can't just give you one without giving you a warning, and I'm sure the guys are relaying that.
This is the piece of racetrack we're talking about. If you go to the other side of that curb, or at least on the other side of that yellow line, too many times he can be slapped on the wrists, which is what's happened here.
Yeah, so, I mean, look, this is making it exciting for the finish. 5 seconds for these guys between these two cars that are racing on circuit. When you add that at the end, hopefully if there's no safety cars, you know, if they finish within 5 seconds of each other over the checkered flag, and then they had that penalty at the end, we'll, it'll definitely make it interesting. They're actually trying to wrestle that car.
Still lap by lap, the squirk out is approaching. Another second taken out that last time by.
Just 31 seconds inside that window now.
There he is. I know I keep harping on about it, but a safety car right now would be a total game changer for this team. If they could get in before the safety car came out, because they're not allowed to pit during the safety car period. I know it's very much hypothetical, and you would need to know that someone's off the track to be able to pull it off, but they could essentially go a lap up in the race if that was to happen, and that's game set match.
But we don't want that.
No, we don't. We do not want that right now, because this is shaping up to be a very interesting battle between the front three without the safety car. It'll just about seal it, though, for the squirk out if it was to come out, and also help the Quinn family quite a lot, too, because their two cars would definitely get a big free kick out of that. Ashton Marty going past the new Lamborghini of Mark Brooks. He's running a little wide as well. Jim Manolis.
The other thing we've got to remember with the Medici and Padayachi car is the two faster drivers are going to hop in. So I'd imagine George and John Martin will be quicker than either Liam Talbot or Jake Foraker. So while Liam's doing a great job at the moment with who he's up against, if they all come out in that after that last pit stop near each other, I'm sure the other guys will probably have a little bit more pace. But we'll wait and see what the lap times produce.
Here's the Hackett Mercedes coming through. Turn number one. This is sixth and seventh on the track. Starting into the next round of pit stops soon. The Wood McMillan car just pitted earlier on lap 62, so he's got both their pit stops out the way. So if you haven't heard the news, the number 95 car is going to receive a 5-second post-race penalty. This is the battle group, first to second.
Just to remind everybody, these two cars have very different pit stop times. Oh, Padayachi loses the front and loses some time. He's been almost flawless. Since hopping in this car on lap 22, he's barely made an error. And such a tiny moment in turn one cost him nearly 2 seconds.
Yeah, he's driving, he's heating up the rear tyres a little bit too much. You can just see him, he's wanting to get on with it, just rushing it a bit too much. The sun's out, the track's warmed up. And, yeah, one of the biggest moments he'll have in his life through turn one at Eastern Creek at about 200 k's an hour.
Now lapping that new Huracan. Oh, now Matt Andy's slipping around. He'd be very cautious not to go exceeding the track limits anymore, that's for sure.
Yeah, I'll be interested to see what happens if he actually does any more. I'm sure he's been told on the radio and he's making a conscious effort not to now, but if he continues or has a couple more, are they going to add to that penalty?
It's very possible.
Normally it ends up being a drive-through. If you do any more, once you've already had the warning or applying a penalty, the next thing could be a drive-through. So
Archie's almost completely closed that gap back up. Took him half a lap. So after a big slide, he's managed to close that gap and steal that race. Let's slow things down for a moment here at Sydney Motorsport Park and just watch how these cars move through the very fast turn one. Talk us through the differences between some of these cars, Dean.
Yeah, look, there's different year models out there. So cars that are like the Aston here, it's about 4 years old. So the aero package might be as efficient as some of the newer cars. But then in a straight line, we saw it just pulling away from Padayachi like it had an extra 50 horsepower. But that's just that drag factor. So all these newer cars, the Mercedes we can see there, that has so much downforce when you're following it through the high-speed corners. If you're not in something that's as new, it just sticks to the road like glue. So,
same rule again, applies for the Audi.
Yeah, so that whole balance of performance for this category, you know, cars, all these newer cars, they end up with faster cars through corners, but slower in a straight line just to for that drag effect. But it all ends up coming out in the wash, and they're always constantly changing the restrictors in the engine to give a car more power if it's deficient somewhere else, or less power if it's really fast. So as we see there, you know, tyre deflection through turn one. Those Pirelli tyres have got their work cut out for them today. Padayachi there we saw just have a moment through turn one, was quite large. Probably didn't look like it on TV, but me sitting here as a driver, I know what that's like. So, again, he's closed that gap. He's pacey, but trying to find a way past in this category. We've all got ABS and traction control. It's quite hard to push someone into a mistake.
And now Paddy Archie looking for the move down the inside.
Watch this, Aston. Watch it down the
straight. This will be a great drag race. They used to run the opposite direction here at Sydney Motorsport Park back in the days.
Giddy up.
But the Aston Martin stretches the legs. And in fact, in he comes.
He's forced it. So.
Oh man. Jump on the anchors. It's the second Aston Martin that's going to serve its second stop now. So all these guys will be good to go to the finish. This will be just about on the 55% marker at the end of this race once John Martin takes reins of the Padayachi Porsche once again.
So expect to see the Medici car in next lap. It's these guys have forced their head and they'll mirror them. Luffy hopping back in the McLaren. Tough day for these guys. Car's not performing as well as they'd hoped.
Now it's getting warmer and it's just going to make life difficult with the turbo.
Yep.
Although the Porsche seems to be handling it quite well. So this should equal 53 laps in the car for the pro guys when they get in now and race to the finish, which should be just about bang on that 55% marker, Matt. It's cutting it fine.
Timed it well, yeah.
Done their math.
John Martin, just cruise. Yep, no worries. Get out, mate. Good job. Give him
a handshake.
Is that
how you say it normally?
Not in supercars. Yeah, we've got 16 seconds to get out and in, but 2 minutes is plenty of time. Nice and relaxed. Move the steering column, all the creature comforts.
Turn the aircon on, play with the radio.
Yeah. These guys obviously aren't running a cool suit. Not sure if that car's got aircon. No, it's actually on runners, that seat. So all the creature comforts. John Martin there just, he would have been watching the pace, and we've got 34 laps to run.
Make sure that the Hans device is under the straps. Otherwise, it doesn't really work.
But this will be qualifying laps now from here till the end, I reckon, between these two, Medici and Martin.
Dan Gaunt, fast Kiwi, chasing down the Interlude Lamborghini here in the hands of Glenn Wood. Glenn Wood having a really good year in 2016 driving that Lambo. Getting right out of the track limits there, but Gaunt still manages to find a way through at six.
Yeah, so first weekend for Dan Gaunt driving the McLaren. And it's not at its best this weekend. All McLarens are suffering a little bit with a bit of imbalance, so he's not as comfortable in that. He drove Quinny's Aston at the Phillip Island endurance round. But he's still out there. I'm in here. And, he's having some fun. I'm not saying I'm not having fun with you guys, but...
You're going to hurt my feelings, Andy.
No, come on. Love you guys.
You're welcome back anytime to come commentate. Looking forward to seeing how you go at Bathurst with the champ this year as Gaunt comes by to tick off another lap. Interestingly,
Medici's still not in. And yeah. 28 seconds between him and Talbot. So, how long? It was 72 laps, I think, Foraker said he was going to get in.
Between laps 70 and 72,
72,
yeah.
So we'll see them in as well soon and a much shorter pit stop.
Oh, a bit of drama going on down here. Someone refuel the car.
Yeah. So I thought you were doing it.
The squirt car will actually come out in front of the Medici and car, won't it?
With the additional 5 seconds at the end?
At the end, no, they will come out
Ahead of them by about 8 seconds, won't they?
They should come out ahead of the Porsche, but not the Aston Martin. They'll be, between the two of them by the looks of it.
Yeah, gotcha.
So
that's right, yeah.
9 seconds difference between the Aston Martin and the squirt Audi, but a much greater difference.
So they'll come out effectively in second.
Yeah.
Sorry, crunching
the
numbers here.
Right, so
you've got an abacus working overtime.
Maths was never your subject in high school, was it?
Never mind.
You would have been the worst high school student. I could just imagine.
I attended. I'll leave it at that.
Bachelor of Attendance, Dean Canto.
We got the bare minimum done, didn't we? Three terms, I think it was.
I like Mad Andy's old helmet design as well. That's pretty cool.
Retro.
Yeah. Got a bit of Stefan Beloff about it.
Yes.
As they shoehorn George Medici into the car. Fold his legs in.
Yeah, I don't think I could ever partner George.
You'd need a serious seat insert. Well, he could
just,
on top of his
He could just stay in there and actually hold me. I'd just hop
on his lap.
He'd do the pedals, I'd do the wheel.
Well, I wonder if they're going to... I wonder if they're going to break the bad news to Jake Foraker and say, you're on the bench, son, because Talbot's laps are good and he can drive to the finish. It would be cruel, but... I mean, what are they going to do about this? Because Liam Talbot is on fire right now.
And look, it's all about laps. As you said, he raced at Spa, and 24 hours, you get plenty of laps in, so...
Jack needs the experience too. He's a rookie. Like I said, just his second race meeting, so it'd be good for him to be doing it, but... What do they do?
But we're all... Oh, bit of a...
Coolant.
Typical Aston. That's all right, just a little overflow breather at the back there. And, now we've just got to wait, serve the time penalty.
You don't see that in the Bond movies.
No.
Coolant dripping out of the back of them.
No, normally it's missiles firing at the back or the oil slick for the car behind, yeah.
So this has put Talbot in the lead. This is good stuff. What a huge shock result this would be if Talbot and Foraker could get up. Imagine that for Jake Foraker in his second race, winning one of these. He was second on debut, actually, Talbot, at the 2013 Phillip Island 101. That was a cool event. Actually got to see Neil Crompton run 200 metres from the start of that race. They got the Le Mans 24-hour old
school.
Yeah,
that's right. I raced at Highlands there, yeah.
Who's your partner with the Highlands?
Andrew Taplin. So I said, look, your legs are longer than mine.
You're doing the running.
And I'll sit in the car. And we led three quarters of that race, but... strategy didn't work out for us in the end.
The Conville back in. Life after 40 is won as a race car driver for Cam McConville.
Yeah, he's come back bouncing, hasn't he?
Given up the job at Cam's, wants to become a race driver again on the grid at Sandown this year.
Yeah, it's an addictive drug, being a race driver, and it's an expensive drug.
So he's taking over from Adrian Dietz in the number 8 Ferrari. Talbot still lapping away here. He's going to come in. So they are going to put Jake back in his car, and that's good for Jake. He deserves to be in this car for a good stint at the end. Get some more laps on the board. But Liam Talbot has driven this thing through the field with the stint of the race. What a drive to close up on the leaders and lead at the end of the race into pit lane.
Yeah, after starting 15th, coming through traffic, not a mark on the car.
Just going to get the maximum done here. 54 laps he's achieved in this one.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter for him because
he's the second driver.
He's the second driver.
Of course, yes.
He could drive to the flag for all they care.
They're going to keep him in though. No,
they will put Foraker back in.
It could have been a fuel thing.
I'm crunching numbers while you guys are talking about
yourself. Right. Right.
Speaking of bad math students.
Yeah, exactly right.
Getting his insert out. I think a bit of a height difference between the two of these guys. Insert going in, so here's GD.
What a rough horse, a dark horse for a podium today, Talbot and Foraker. That'd be a great story indeed. Good luck to them for the remainder of this race. Now Grant Denyer out on track. We saw them pop up just like this at the 101. It was a race that went safety car free, and when all was said and done, with all the big names like Tander and Shane Van Gisbergen racing, it was the McLaren that popped up at the end after the second pit stop phase.
Yeah, look, they're running around in fourth, well, just before the pit stop started then. So I think effectively they're fourth, even after all these pit stops. He's going to cross the line in a second. If he doesn't come in, he'll be the effective leader, but he still has to complete his second pit stop, obviously. Again, Phillip Island, they weren't the quickest car out there. They've had that starter issue again.
Beats McConville Ferrari. I'm
surprised they're letting them clutch start it because, you'd never normally...
Very NASCAR-esque, isn't it?
Yeah, get it out. Feel the rhythm, feel the ride.
Denyer and Morecambe, not always the quickest car out there, but just consistent. Look after the car, look after the tyres. And we saw them come away with a win at Phillip Island. And if they just consolidate here today, they'll still be leading the championship with a bag full of points.
They put on lap 29. Traffic ahead here with the Richards BMW. The walls and Luff entry now. Winging their way across the top side of the circuit here. Lap 73, second round of pit stops underway. Race the flag from this point. Denyer, the leader, has driven very well today. Done past a couple of occasions.
McLaren versus McLaren down here. Denyer knows it's the experienced Warren Luff on the approach. Lets him through. Not for position, so
exactly
smart. Luff getting his lap back on the DPO techno-operated Just Cuts 650S McLaren. That was a mouthful. And still Max Twing in this car at the moment. So they'll be handing that car over very shortly, I imagine. Car number 100.
Well, Dean Canto's going to head back out and get into the Toyota 86. This has been a good warm-up for you, I reckon, Dean. You're in the zone now.
Yeah, mate, I'm all good. So I'll be watching this race once I hop out. But been good working with you guys.
Just remember, turn five.
Yeah, seven. I'll try and get four this time. But it's a bit more important now. I've got qualifying coming up. I'm going to hand over to Nick now, Percat. He's a bit familiar with this category as well. But, no, great race so far. No safety cars again. And good battles.
Good luck today, mate.
Thanks, guys.
In the Toyota 86 series later on the weekend. Qualifying for that will be next on our schedule here. And Cameron, we've got a Ferrari in the pits. What else is happening down there?
I thought I'd grab Liam Tell, but we talked about him. What a great stint, Liam, from you. But endurance racing, we're calling this an endurance. You've just won at Spa in a 24-hour.
Yeah, it kind of feels like a sprint race. I'm ready to jump in and go again and then go again, but only one go, but that's heaps of fun.
Mate, the car looked like a jet out there.
The car was mega. It's a real Audi track because you can use all that aero in the high-speed corners. And, yeah, it looked after the tyres a bit more and just going through turn one almost flat. It's just unbelievable.
Did you get on the radio and ask, oh, can I stay out here for another one?
Yeah. Yeah, I wish I could have stayed out.
Oh, good luck. Fingers crossed.
Yeah, fingers crossed. Thank you.
Thanks, Cam. Down the pits. We do our own pit stop up here with our driver change. And welcome in 2016 Clipsal 500 champ, Nick Percat. Welcome to the call, mate.
It's good. Good to be back in here. It's nice and warm.
Nice and warm.
A lot of screens, a lot of information. Perfect.
Now, your boy, your protege, if you will, been in the pits. It's been a tough day for him.
It has the Rullo machine, the Lamborghini there. It's had a front splitter issue and looks like it's actually broken some bolts in the front end and obviously had to retire the car, so unfortunate. He hasn't had a good run lately and feel fit for Pete Rullo. He's not been an amazing year in that car, so hopefully they can finish off the year well and just get a few results and actually finish a few races out of a few mechanical issues.
He caught your attention last year during the Shannon's National Series and really he's got a massive future ahead of him.
Yeah, Alex, he's a good young kid. He's humble young guy, knows he's quite young and definitely can drive a car fast. So, yeah, it'd be good to see what he can do later in the year. You know, he's had a bit of a bad run in the Dunlop Series, so got a few test days coming up with him, try and give him a bit more help. And, yeah, he can definitely drive a car fast. It's just someone who's 15 years old, you need to kind of give him a fair bit of information because they don't actually know much. They've come straight out of karts and straight into V8 supercars, so it's impressive.
This race is setting up to be a thriller in the end here. We've had a couple of really big battles all race long. It's a category you're pretty familiar with.
Yeah, exactly. I was in the Bathurst 12-hour, didn't go to plan. Then caught up at turn two on lap one and then drove the car at Phillip Island. And that was a weekend where there was a lot of punches for some reason with the Pirelli. So I didn't actually get to do anything there. So I did a couple laps. But, yeah, I've been watching it all year, obviously, especially with Alex and Pete in it. So, it looks like it's been a good race so far.
So the Bow Edwards Ferrari leaves after his second pit stop. Lap 75. Let's check out some highlights. Gives you a chance to bring you up to speed here. It was contact earlier on here with Emilier Audi down here at turn number four. This was on like the second or third lap with Antunes down the inside, treating like it was a dash race.
That's fairly committed.
Absolutely. Cool. Number 69, 19, sorry, I should say, the Mercedes getting on the grass down there at the turn six complex. And this is the moment where Peter Rullo spun on cold tyres around the back of Corporate Hill and the number five Audi had flashbacks to 2015.
Rubbing's racing,
for,
eh?
For 101 laps, they were treated like it was a 10-lapper, that's for sure. This was the Wiedecke Lubrimax Aston Martin down the inside here at turn number four. We had this issue in the pits with the fuel rig that was full of pressure and pumping fuel at the top, and that would have compromised the Quinn McLaren that was on vapours anyway. And that was a big moment for the Dietz and McConville Ferraris. Had a troublesome day out there in car number eight, the Denya Morka McLaren. Denya has driven really, really well today. The same too for this guy, Devashan Padiachi, aboard the Walkinshaw GT3, the 911 car that started from pole position. The second round of pit stops continued on, and we're now racing to home. This 101 lap race, 26 laps to go. We're 1 hour and 58 minutes into it. As now, the Denya Morka car in the pits. Oh, it's a flash of flame here.
And a fire out the left-hand side of the Styx McLaren. Get the extinguishers on it, boys. There it is. A bit too far away in the pit.
See him just close a little window there just as the fire extinguisher goes off. Just quickly. Don't want to get covered in this.
Cool as you like. They handled it quickly. No shortage of fire extinguishers down in the pits. What a day they're having. their fuel rig was leaking fuel before their first stop, and now they're... Oh dear.
What a tough day. They've driven the wheels off this car, and it's just been the pits that have been the letdown for them.
Looks like they're going to maybe press on. Give the car a wipe.
So, up came on the jacks.
So when he refined it.
Amazing small fire for such a... Considering how much fuel had just been put in the car. As to why that would have happened. But look at things completely covered in extinguisher foam.
Pressing on, though. It's
and now they're
see.
Finally finishing that tyre stop that they needed. They might not lose all that much time out of this. It was a long pit stop anyway, 2 minutes 10, so yep. Could just about get this covered anyway.
Looks like they're giving a nice wipe over. They, you can see where their mechanics there. That's where they have the kill switch and fire extinguisher buttons, so they've obviously set off the firebomb in the car there.
Well, we've had a fair bit of action as we are just ticking over the two-hour mark of round number 2 of the Australian Endurance Championship. This car will have a 5-second penalty at the end of the race for exceeding track limits earlier when Andrew was in the car. George driving it right now, back in after that second pit stop. And the Walkinshaw Porsche is in the hunt. Ryan Walkinshaw here this week, and he's back from Monaco. Cam, what's the latest with Ryan?
Yeah, from Monaco to Sydney Motorsport Park, Ryan Walkinshaw all over the world, mate, in a very good spot at the moment, Johnny Martin, and I hear you're expanding your GT program.
Yeah, we're hoping to. You know, we're really, really proud and really happy to be playing a part in the GT category in Australia at the moment. So, yeah, we dipped our toe in the water this year with one car, but, yeah, ideal situation is we'll increase that for next season.
You must have been very proud of your pole position overnight as well.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You know, the guys have been working really, really hard, and, you know, Porsche giving us a fantastic product to work with. We've got some great drivers as well, so we always felt it was coming. You know, had a couple of hiccups trying to get there, but on the whole, we've been pretty consistent and been showing that, you know, it's a good team that we're creating here. So, you know, as we end up learning the product more and more, hopefully we'll have a few more pole positions and hopefully a couple of victories to come as well.
I was going to say, hopefully victory today, maybe a couple of victories this weekend.
Yeah, we always hope so. I'm not going to jinx it, though.
Thanks, Ryan.
No worries, thank you.
It's good to have him back in Australia. Looking more and more like his old man every day, I reckon, as well. So cool to have that name, Walkinshaw, still in Australian motorsport.
There it is.
There we go, back on track. Oops.
Wave.
Getting rid of some more foam out of the window as he goes.
I love that he stayed so calm when there's a fire to think, you know what, I'm just going to close this little window here so I don't get covered in it. It's very calm, cool and collected considering.
Well, there's a lot of panic going on around him, but yep. Clark Quinn was probably the coolest in that situation out of anybody. Here he comes back now, diving into turn one. And that should be... I imagine Dan Gaunt staying in that car, so it would have been Dan actually sitting in there. It says on our timing screens that he is still in the car. So they've gone for a different strategy here, Nick. A lot of drivers started with the pro driver, but they started with their AM driver and put Dan in for a double stint at the end of the race.
Yeah, it's something you can definitely look at doing with this category in the format, especially if you have someone like Clark, who's obviously a very fast driver himself, and he can hold his own against like the likes of Craig Baird and stuff. So, smart move. Now, Dan Gaunt will be hustling at home and hopefully they get a good result, especially, you know, you look at the car, they've obviously had a bad day.
It slipped off our radar a little bit in terms of supercar environment. I mean, we saw him as a co-driver 2013, I think, the last time with Nissan was the last time we had him. We'll talk more about him in a second, but let's get down to the pits with Kylie.
Andrew Medeke, no one likes a penalty, but in this case, you're in a pretty good position, your thoughts?
Yeah, look, it's to be honest, I deserved it. The car, I got the guys to change the car last night a little bit to get rid of some understeer, and we end up with a lot of oversteer, which in my sim, was the car was a real handful, and it was difficult to keep on the road, let alone on the track. So I did it twice or three times, and so that 5 seconds is fair enough. But the car still had, we still had enough speed to stay in the front, and we undid that adjustment when we came into the pits, and George is in there, and man, he's so fast in this car, nobody's going to touch him, I don't reckon.
And what about the different marks in this category. We saw the Aston Martin strong in some parts, the Porsche in others. It's been a real battle out there.
It really has. Now, that's something, one good thing about this category. A V12 Aston Martin is a little bit faster in the straight, but the Porsche is more agile. And if ever it comes to a wet race, we won't see which way they go. So, you know, it's all fair, but, I think we've got the car for this track. Lots of medium-speed corners, and we've got big wings and a lot of aero. So, no, we're looking good. I'm very happy.
He's got a smile on his face, enjoying a weekend at the track with his son. And they're leading it as well. 20 seconds clear now with that second pit stop complete of John Martin. And he needs to get home 15 seconds clear. And on top of this, he's just obliterated the lap record by 2/10. So George has really lowered his eyes, knows the target, knows what he needs to do. He needs to keep a 5-second gap over this car. But at the moment, it's a 20-second gap after that pit stop window. And if he's going to keep going out there turning lap records, that's really going to help Mick.
It is, and you know, you can see John's driving the wheels off the Porsche. And hey, George is, he looks really smooth, really under control. The car's not out of shape, and the lap time is so consistent where I think maybe the Porsche is a couple of tenths of lap faster, but occasionally they lose half a second of traffic or bits and pieces. So the gap's actually flared out another couple of seconds over the last few laps. So it's a crazy race, and especially with the different speed levels in some cars. So George doing a good job. It's good to see a father-son combo like that. You know, they're pretty fresh into GTs and, you know, started off a little bit slow, but they've really gained some real good momentum this year. And George is a ripping bloke, and obviously his old man's a good guy too. So it's good to see him. And I like the way he just admits complete fault for getting a penalty. He's like, oh, I changed the car and got them to put that back, and now it's good.
We've got a father-son combo coming first and last at the moment. Unfortunately, Marcus Marshall never got to start the Super Barn Audi. Here comes Antunes at the moment trying to chase down that last spot on the podium. It's definitely within his sights. So 4 acres time, 1 minute 31.8. 2.6 seconds quicker that last time by Nathan Antunes is on a charge.
He is. He's a very good GT driver, and I think he's actually chasing potentially his old car from last year. So there's always extra motive when you're chasing the car that you were in the previous year. I know I was definitely guilty of it last year with Lee Holdsworth when he's had my chariot. So, he's coming fast. How nice is the new Audi inside? It's very F1, DTM. And Nathan does a good job. He goes from Audi, McLaren. He just seems to jump in everything and super fast all the time.
Very talented, yeah.
What are the plans for you with this category? You had a stint at the Bathurst 12-second this year, which is what I'll call it for you because that's about as long as the race lasted for you. Next year, I know you've got good ties with the Walkinshaw kind of brand. Is there a chance that you might be able to snare a seat in that Porsche?
The Porsche would be really good. Obviously, I've got a bit of history with Porsche and I've got a good relationship with Walkinshaw, and be a good fit, but also, building a little bit of a relationship with McLaren in Melbourne, and I'm doing some stuff at Classic Adelaide in McLaren road car, so hopefully I'll have a 12-hour drive and hopefully I get past turn two.
Watch out for those fins, all right?
Yes, it was an awesome experience. How's the car bottoming out through turn one? It's to go to Bathurst, I spoke to Garth about it and a few others. We have such a muscle memory of a V8 supercar there that you come up a bit wide there for
change for third. So, Antunes goes through.
Yes, you have such a muscle memory of a V8 supercar that when you get into GTs, you nearly need to give yourself a bit of a slap going across the top, saying, keep your foot down. You need to use the aero. The faster you go, generally, the more grip you get to a certain extent. So,
and remember, you're in a left-hand drive.
And that. So, it took a little bit to get going, but, yeah, qualifying last 12 hours, unreal, and I want to have another crack at it, definitely.
Yeah, looking forward to the 12-hour again when it ticks around next year. So, Denyer out of this car. The Justin Cutts car has been handed back over now. Denyer still showing up in that car, but that should be Nathan Morecambe now in there in P5. And they will also be trying to chase down that last spot on the podium.
Fifth position, but about 20 seconds behind. And it'll be the 4-acre car now. And Chiz needs to find about 7/10 of a second a lap here. He wants to catch down the guys ahead with 20 laps to go.
He's actually a second up on John.
So it's working
his
already.
Lap. Yeah, so he's having
turned
a red hot.
A wink. It's looking good for Mediki though at the moment. Lap record in his pocket. Driving very fast. And as the weather gets warmer, it'll probably help the V12 natural aspirated car over the Porsche. Same rule applies for these McLarens, to be honest. They don't historically go well in the heat. They do like cool conditions, although it didn't really slow them down at the 12 hour.
Didn't, but they also had Shane behind the wheel. Yeah.
Doesn't matter what weather you've got.
Exactly. So much experience in the McLaren and that car now. When you go drive the thing at Spa, Monza, and all those sorts of places, and against such a high level of GT driver around the world, I think when he comes back here in the 12 hour, it's probably a little bit more relaxed, even though the weekend's so big now. It's in his home little pond and he gets it.
Well, it's obviously been a great year for the Techno team. That is the 12 hour winning car on screen, and Cam has found one of their 12 hour winning drivers.
Yeah, I've got Jono Webb, team boss. Not just the driver, team boss. Only one car today, which is slightly different to the GT Championship. Does that change your focus much?
No, it just means it's a lot more relaxed to sit back. One V8 supercar, one McLaren GT, and it's easy weekend. But no, it's just a one for the endurance races. And at the moment, yeah, we're doing all right. We're obviously leading the championship after Phillip Island. Probably not quite as competitive today as what we like, but we're in front of the guys behind us. We're in front of the guys, the points that are behind us, so not all bad.
Now, Jono, in the GTs, you had brake dramas at Townsville. I pestered you with it all day. No dramas this weekend so far?
No, not at all. We're trying something a little bit different at Townsville. Just trying up the ante there and the heat of Townsville, the street circuit, things like that got to the car. But got it all sorted now. We had a test here a couple of weeks ago, and things run faultless so far.
All right, mate. Still plenty more to go today.
Yeah, there is, but no, we're in the right place at the moment. We're enjoying it. We're smiling.
Thanks, Jono.
Thank you.
Great to have Cameron Vandendungen down in pit lane with Kylie King. We have just 19 laps to go. We're 2 hours and 10 minutes and counting. It's a round two of the Australian Endurance Championship. The car that we're looking at, the Denyer and Morecambe Just Cut 650S car, is currently inside the top five and closing rapidly on fourth. Still got a bit of time to make up yet. John Bowers in the pits in the second of the Maranello cars. There he is, a very familiar face. Probably seen him on the telly before, but he also doubles as a pretty handy race car driver.
He does. He does a good job. You know, he's obviously not in the cars as often as other people, and he's obviously got quite a serious job outside of this. And I was pretty impressed with him at Phillip Island. You know, obviously had a really good result there, and another good one on today if they can keep trucking along like this.
George Medici looking like leaving Sydney Motorsport Park, not just with a race win, a trophy that he'll share with his dad, but also the lap record. Looking very quick today. Big chunks of rubber forming off the racing line. It's inevitable in a two-hour, three-hour endurance race, isn't it?
It is, especially, you know, pretty soft tyre, the Pirelli. The deck, they seem to have no tyre degradation, which is amazing. It's every driver's dream. And to be driving away, so another three laps later, he's put another 2 seconds into John Martin, who's a very, very experienced GT driver, and, you know, driven all around the world, and it's seriously impressive. And obviously, Walkinshaw Racing, they're not here just to have fun, so I'm pretty blown away by the way that both Medecis have driven today.
And Nick, we've seen some big names that have gone away overseas back when you started your career a few, 10 years ago now, and you've seen some of these guys come back to Australia after having a crack internationally.
Yeah, definitely. I was 1 year behind John Martin in Formula Ford, so I watched him battle it out with Tim Slade. Antunes went overseas. There's been a few of them who've all gone over. Dom Storey's obviously done all his racing overseas. And so for them to come here now, it's a little bit different. Obviously, they probably perceive Australia's competition to be a little bit weaker. Back maybe 10 years ago it was, but they've come back and they realise that the level here is super high. It's been demonstrated with especially with Carrera Cup this weekend with the local drivers. So I always say, you know, we've got the most competitive, or one of the most competitive championships, be it GTs, be it supercars, even our open wheeler stuff's really competitive. And it is good to see, and the more young guys we have coming through, I know everyone wants to have a crack at F1, but it makes our field stronger, be it Australian GT or be it supercars.
This will be for position here, guys. We're speaking about Dom Storey and how much racing he's done overseas. He's chasing down Hayden Cooper, who's in the Darrell Lee car. Here comes our leader to put these guys a lap down. George Medici not taking prisoners today.
That is unreal. That is like Dom. Where's Dom running? Eighth in a fully fledged brand new Mercedes, and the Medecis are going to put him a lap down. You know, I missed a little bit of the race. I'm not sure. Did Dom have an issue or just trucked along? So that's serious pace. Let's see what time George does now with a bit of traffic.
All right, this time through, it'll be a 1:29.9.
29 passing cars.
So that's still very fast. We currently have, guys, four drivers under the old lap record now, Dom Storey being one of those. So that goes to show how quick he is. Miguel Molina, our visitor, also on the list, as the Mercedes throws it up the inside and puts Hayden Cooper back a spot. The Lubrimax, used to say Camaro, but it's the Aston Martin, comes flying through behind him, and unfortunately, it's day done for the Lambo. Stuck in the pits. Love the big V10 hanging in the back. But also, guys, Craig Baird on a charge. He's turning lap record speed as well, a 1:27.93 earlier in the race for him. A chance to pick up a few more spots. Baird back in 12th. Should be able to climb inside the top 10 by the end of this one. And as I say that, he goes to 11th.
Be good for Dom now. Obviously, he'd be able to bench himself against the guy who's leading the race. He's 10th quicker in the first sector, but George seems to have the eyes on today. Dom's been super fast all weekend, so it'll be good to see how he goes up against the Aston.
Did you drive with Dom in
Super Tour? I was just about to mention, I drove him in the Super Tour. He's really good friends of Fabian Coulthard, and Fabian couldn't come to a round, and obviously we all hang out together. So I went over and had a play with him at Bukakoi, and I still say, a bit of a smart ass, he was faster than me in a supercar or a Super Tour. And especially Pukekohe, he's a really fast driver, and I definitely think he's underrated. I tried to help him get a drive in the main series this year, and you know, he was a bit nervous for it, but I thought he could do a really good job, and he proves it in these. He's really fast, and he's just done a 30 in the traffic. And
Almost had a moment down there.
He was 3/10 faster than George that lap, passing the same car, so he can definitely drive.
Great school friends with Shane Van Gisbergen, and even shared a room with our own Dan Ricciardo many, many years ago.
It's amazing how small the world is and what people have done.
Yeah. Second on the track is John Martin. Love the sound of this boxer engine in the Porsche. Listen to it down here at turn two. So cool. Martin with some campaigns in the Le Mans 24 Hour in his back pocket. Had a good stint in LMP2 in the World Endurance Championship, which is essentially one rung off being at the top level of sports car racing in the world. So that's a very impressive piece of his history, and also had a stint in Carrera Cup last year before stepping up to lead this Walkinshaw Porsche campaign. And interesting to hear Ryan Walkinshaw mention that they are definitely keen to expand next year. Would love to see this car on the grid for the 12 hour. And imagine if Porsche want to essentially reach out to their global list of drivers and bring them in for Bathurst next year.
That would be a sight to see. You know, the likes of Nick Tandy, he's seriously speedy driver, and he does a lot of miles in this spec Porsche, and obviously a Le Mans winner outright. But I was actually teammates Nick in the 2008 Formula Ford Festival, and he has no worry in having a red hot go. So I'd love to see him at Bathurst, and he's definitely spoken about it. And I'd say a Nick Tandy or a John Martin kind of combo at Bathurst would be seriously fast.
The obvious question here is, we don't know who's going to be driving the Walkinshaw supercars next year, but do you reckon a part of that supercars deal would be to also drive the Porsche at some point as well?
You'd probably say definitely now. Unfortunately, they've lost the Holden Racing Team brand and the factory money, so now there's no issue, I guess, with driving a different manufacturer's car. So I know I would be thinking if it's James and Garth again next year, that'd be keen to have a crack at a GT car, especially Garth's doing a bit of it, but James did so much in Japan with all that Super GT racing that he would be very keen to get back in an aero car with some sticky toes.
All right, here we go. Audi, it's an R8 in the hands of Sydney local Nathan Enchina's fast corner. Do we go back to fifth there? Nope, no need. Nick, talk us through this part of the track and just how fast this place is.
Seriously fast. So he's broke just past the 100-metre board. He's going to go, it's got good grip. He's made the apex, no issue. So say he's just broken 25 metres later than the supercar. So it's a fair distance. You just see the speed they carry. Minimal roll time, a lot of front aero. Then it's turn four here. Gets on the throttle so early. Uses all the road. I just love the noise of this car. It's seriously cool. You hear the splitter bottoming out every now and again under brakes. That little whine there, that's the compressor actually engaging the gears when he down changes. It
It's cool, the GT cars. You hear the little whines.
Yeah.
The air compressor going off for the gears. And he's driving it very well for somebody who probably hasn't done that many laps in this configuration Audi.
You can bolt him in any car. He's just very, very good. Very talented driver in open wheelers as well.
The thing with the GT car, because they're a little bit quieter inside, you hear all those little nasty bumps. Yeah. And it sounds horrendous, but it's not doing any damage. It's just bottoming out that look, the front splitter on the front of the car there. So how cool does that look with that matte silver?
Gap's blown out now to 35 seconds between and Martin. So Martin has responded to it. If he wants to get on with it, he needs to find 2.5 seconds a lap. Lap 89. So closing stages. Let's see Ellingham Fastway Courier's entry. Tony D'Alberto behind him, the number three. Safety car free. Everyone's driven very, very well out there today.
I honestly thought I was over in our catering having a bit of breakfast this morning watching the start, and I thought there might have been a little bit of action, especially cold morning. The Pirelli seemed to take 4, 5, 6 laps to really hook up, so they drove really well in that opening part of the race when it would have been pretty tricky. The track's been definitely slippery this weekend with the amount of rain in Sydney, so, a bit of a massage post-podium. Pre-podium, sorry.
Sprung.
He almost fell asleep.
Has pretty good faith in his son. If that was my dad, he would be pacing up and down. Yeah. Unfortunately, he will hate me. Just a bit of a smoker, probably have like 16 cigarettes out of his mouth, stressed. So that's pretty impressive, just getting a massage.
It's all right, Dad, chill.
Yeah.
Couldn't be any more relaxed back there at the moment. He'd be nodding off if he was any more relaxed in the pits. Looking very cool, calm and collected at the moment. I've seen it all before, haven't they? We were saying earlier, Nick, that Andrew competed here back in 1990 when the Australian Endurance Championship was here.
Did he win that one?
Came third with Peter Brock.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
that's cool.
So a couple of podiums will go all right at this place. There's only a good 10, 11 laps to go on this one, so we are closing in. This race has flown by. Amazing to think we've gone nearly 5 hours in this championship without a safety car, with the entire Phillip Island race, and now this one going SC3.
This is Morecambe about to go past the Shields McPherson iMac Porsche. Not for position. This guy's running back in fifth at the moment.
McPherson will be hopping into one of those new Huracan GT3 Lamborghinis next year. We saw this earlier with the
Solomon car.
Yeah, with the Solomon, the older model. Well, that's the difference between the old model AMG and the new model. The new model manages to gather it back up when it drops the wheel off.
The anti-spin.
Yeah.
Noticed I was in the garage with Andre watching, and I saw Dom seriously wide down there early in the race, and I thought, maybe it was just a bit odd, but yeah, sitting on the opposite side of the car to what you're used to, so a little bit greedy on the entry, and turn six, it does feel like it narrows a little bit, and you try and open up the corner, so that'll have his attention, definitely.
Good save. Cost him a little bit of time, but definitely good save. So Jack LeBrock's lap record that was set in... Actually, could have been set in that car that we saw turn around earlier, the older model AMG. I know it was definitely one of those cars. It could be actually that very car that set the lap record here with Jack LeBrock, JLB, in the car. And it's been taken away today by the Aston Martin. Yes, that's still the current model Aston Martin, but it's a few years into its tenure now. It's impressive that the older model cars are doing so well here today.
It is. And like we heard Andrew Meneke speak earlier, medium speed kind of what are you doing, mate?
Total race fan. He's getting up there and close and personal. He would have already spent about an hour in the Porsche Carrera Cup paddock looking at all the cars over there. He's as close as he can get to the action. Look at him.
The ultimate race fan.
I'm going to ask him for a car-by-car description of the corner exit of the hairpin now. Who has the best traction control system?
He's been riding a Ducati each day to the track.
Has he?
Yeah, very top gun spec this weekend. Here's Greg Rust. He's loving his action here at Sydney Motorsport Park. Part of the Red Rooster Sydney Super Sprint. We've still got plenty more Virgin Australia Supercar action to come up. Practice, qualifying and a race. Towards the end, we've got Carrera Cup Asia, Carrera Cup Australia. And next on track will be qualifying for the Toyota Racing Series as well. So, unbelievable, the little 86s. Toyota 86 Racing Series coming up soon.
Every car, every speed.
Pretty much, yeah. We've got you covered absolutely all the way through.
It's going to be a massive day on the couch because Formula One follows this later on this afternoon. Yep. NASCAR later tonight. It's kind of jealous we can't be sitting on the lounge.
Should I see Red Bull Racing 1-2, Spa
you
practice?
Did.
Very good.
You're looking good. Our boy Dan coming up in qualifying later tonight. It makes sense, doesn't it, this place with variety? I mean, it's the home of the Triple Challenge back in the day.
Yep.
is to get all sorts of bikes, cars, drag racing all happening in the one venue. Good history, 26 years, 500cc motorcycles back in the day. And now very much at home with this category. A1 GP raced here for a couple of years.
I remember coming to watch that, drove over from Melbourne.
So this is the gap at the moment between the leaders. So there goes the Aston Martin. Oh, that is a big lead right now. Never mind your 5-second penalty. They can serve just about an entire stop-go penalty and still get out back in front of the Porsche. It's been a great drive from the Medici family. Father-son combo looks like they're in for a bit of a win today.
I wouldn't say John's given up. You can see he didn't use the curb through the second last corner. He's looking after the car. He knows he's in a very good position and huge gap to third. So as much as you want to go fast and push on, there is definitely a point where you need to look after the car there. The front splitters are very fragile on these cars and they're so low to the ground. He's avoiding the big sawtooth curbs and just bringing it home to get a podium for the Walkinshaw group.
Sat at 36 seconds now, so he's not going to catch that inside the next 8 or 9 laps.
Well, battle for fourth is on though. Here it is. And this is really going to help their championship charge. Jenya and Morecambe, winner of the opening race, off the championship with Phillip Island. If they can win this one, guys, or at least catch fourth here and finish fourth, their championship will be looking very good.
Good moment for Jake Foraker here, though, isn't it, Nick? Young guy.
Yep.
Good chance for him to step up on the big stage this weekend.
He's been pretty impressive. I watched him in Formula Ford when he first came in, and actually when I was working at Sonic, he was racing in the Vic State Series, and our driver was racing against him, and I was a little bit surprised to see him jump into Australian GT. Pretty big jump. He does a lot of driver training, heavily involved with Mercedes-Benz Driver Training Academy, and he's a very hard worker, always going somewhere, driver training, so it's good to be able to see him actually put...
Oh,
that was a great move.
Oh.
They're friends too.
Wouldn't believe it looking at that.
They might be stretching the friendship with that one.
Put a bit of trust in Jake there. It's good to see him, you know, everything that he gets to speak about it, all the driver training stuff, he's showing that, you know, he can walk the walk, and it's good to see.
He's becoming a bit of an endurance specialist, Nathan Morecambe, winner of the 6 Hour at Bathurst with his good friend Chaz Mostert earlier this year, the BMW, and now going to be leading this championship with Grant Denyer as it heads across the ditch to New Zealand for the final 2 rounds. This is a commitment move, this one.
Yeah, it's late too, and they only dabbed the brake in race trim down there, so to actually get up the inside is seriously impressive, and obviously Jake knew he was coming. Probably expected him to pass him at turn two, but he wanted to get through earlier.
Brave move, got it done. That was the position, puts him up now into fourth spot.
And it also puts Jake out on the marbles, and look how strong it is out there. Just about up to the rims of old rubber, and did a really good job to not go understeering off the racetrack down there. Wow, what a bit of vision that is. Look how dusty and dirty it is out there.
Is Luffy, is he only 5-6 seconds behind Foraker?
These guys, yeah, he could very much catch them as well. So, Jake could fall back to sixth at the end of this race. The Aston Martin is having a flawless day. 7 to go this time by. And the Medici's are in for a win here. 20 seconds up on their nearest competitor, the Walkinshaw Porsche. They will have a 5-second post-race penalty. So they've got a 15-second buffer up their sleeve with 7 to go. Looking very nice. Part of the racing where you start to really get nervous, though.
He'll be hoping for minimal traffic, minimal having any risk. I love how relaxed
Matt Andy's had his back massage now.
Yep.
He's chilled, laid back.
I suppose I've got some of their grapes. Someone bring me some.
Hand feeding his grapes. Not long to go in round two. Great way to kick off the big Saturday of racing here at Sydney Motorsport Park. 3 hour enduro. The length of essentially the Sandown 500 to kick things off before we even get into qualifying action for the supercars.
Gap is 18 seconds. He broke the lap record here on lap 73, 127.76. The 5 drivers have done the same thing here. Makes the battle now 5th and 6th. Discount the iMac Porsche. He's a lap down.
It's good. We're going to see another battle here with
Luffy and Jake. So you've got someone super experienced, Warren Luff. What hasn't he driven? He obviously drives every road car in the sun for work outside of this. He's a stunt man. And then you got Jake, first year of GT racing, punching well above his weight. So it's going to be fun.
Well, it's going to be a nervous last few laps, this one for Jake Foraker. Luffy's closing in for the kill. Let's go back down to the pits with Kylie.
Well, all the focus is at the top of the pointing end. Obviously, Peter, you'd love to be there, but still very a competitive race for yourself and Dominic in the Mercedes.
Yeah, look, we had really good practice yesterday. Dom was super quick in qualifying. I've really struggled with the front end over the weekend, and we don't know why. We gave him a new set of tyres to start and a new set to finish with, so really in the middle stint, I just had to try and hold ground. But we went backwards a bit in setup. I think we're P6 or 7 at the moment, which is still good for the championship. We're halfway through, but it's, you know, we hope for a little bit more this weekend.
He's got a big old smile and has plenty of miles in the AMGs as Luff cruises on through. Foraker not really arguing the point there.
2.5 seconds lap quicker on the previous two laps too, so did it pretty easily in the end. The Foraker back to sixth.
Good chance here for Foraker to just follow Warren Luff around, get some experience.
We could be just seeing a little bit of, you know, Jake's in an older spec Audi against a new McLaren. There could be a little bit of tyre deck there. The new car, obviously, you know, no one designs a car to be worse, so it's going to be more efficient over a long run, and especially endurance races, what they're designed to do. So Jake is doing a good job. Still be in the top, let's see, sixth now.
Yep.
Dom Story's next in line to maybe catch it, but he could be a bit too far back.
Yeah, he'd need to get him at a second lap even more if he's going to take that spot off him. So Warren Luff goes up to fifth, doing very nicely. Considering at the beginning of the race, they were really struggling for rear-end grip. The track and the conditions have really come back to the McLaren later in the race.
They dropped right back to 10th, the initial stages of the race.
Yeah.
Fought back hard.
He's second on the road. Closing lap by lap, he's taken another 6 tenths out of him. He's not giving up the fight here, John Martin.
17.7 seconds to George Medici, the Lubrimax Aston Martin. Further down the track, this is John Martin. We took the car back over from Devash and Patiarchy.
Half a second a lap, but it's going to be too little too late, I'm afraid. George really opened up that lead at the beginning of the stint. They also had a shorter pit stop time, which really helped. The whole campaign and the whole reason why Walkinshaw have invested in this team, they focused it around the endurance championship. They debuted the car for real, as we check out the very sorry-looking 650S McLaren of Dan Gaunt and Clark Quinn. But it was all about building to this moment, getting into the Australian Endurance Championship for them.
Yeah, exactly. You're never going to rock up at the first round. And, you know, you can hope to win, but it's definitely difficult in such a competitive category. And they're going to hit the ground. Oh, they're definitely hitting the ground running, coming the Endurance Championship, and probably definitely building up towards the 12-hour. Surely they're going to enter the car. This is really good preparation for that.
Hayden Cooper ahead. Got the Wood McMillan car back in the pits. They've been in and out for the past 10 laps.
It's not a good day for Lamborghinis.
No.
They're pretty much all at the back of the pack at the moment. Trying to find the number one Lamborghini on the board, and I think it's might actually be. Well, the Largo car was out there early. That's down in 22nd. So, yeah, 20th. They're 20th, 21st, 22nd, and 23rd, the four Lambos.
And are they all in pit lane?
Manolis is out there circulating still, but still very much coming to grips with the new car.
Yeah, pretty big challenge. Eastern Creek, or Sydney Motorsport Park, I reckon it's one of the toughest racetracks we go to. There's about 65 surface changes from really old to quite new. So for someone to jump in around here, it's fast track, high risk. That was a nice move. And also chasing the balance of the car from, you know, corner to corner, let alone over a stint.
I mean, Ollie's more experienced with tracks like Phillip Island, for example. He runs in the Victorian Sports Car Championship.
This is Miguel Molina, the Audi DTM star in car number one, sharing with Tony Bates. Tony making that move. Well, he's actually doing double duties this week and also racing in Carrera Cup as well, so not willing to give up racing his Porsche just yet.
But fair enough.
Miguel doing a really good job here. They finished seventh at Phillip Island. Audi factory driver, part of the huge squad of Audi stars spread around Europe. Speaking of Audis, Nathan Antunes on for a podium today.
How good would the race have been, actually, if the top three, we just kind of, like, made them start again together at the last stop? Because they're all just doing exactly the same lap time. It would be cool to see three manufacturers, like, door-to-door.
Yeah, well, it's Aston Martin from Porsche, from Audi, and then a pair of McLarens. So, four different manufacturers inside the top five. Very successful customer program that the Audi runs.
Dom's right behind Jake now.
Pressure's going to be on now for P6 here. Foreka wants it. He's going to have to fend off Dom Story. How about Dan Gorn? They've had so many issues with that car today. It was on fire in the pits earlier, literally. He's still in P8.
He's, that is impressive. He's obviously having a red hot go this last stint. His pace has been really good. Dom pulled sideways off Corbury Hill. That's pretty cool.
Oh, now this is pole position. Older model Audi Ultra versus the brand spanking new AMG.
Hopefully Jake puts up a bit of a fight. He's been pretty nice to the other guys. He knows he's in a good position. There's only going to be roughly two laps to go. So he's feel free to, you know, he could defend this pretty hard to make sure he stays in that top six.
Val Edwards Ferrari behind them too, but not in this battle. The Audi stretches the legs down the Sir Jack Brabham straight. Two laps to go here at Sydney Motorsport Park. The Australian Endurance Championship, round two, the 2016 season.
John Bowen's a piece of this action, but he's actually down a lap. He's got the headlights flashing, and these guys are fighting for position inside the top six, and JB comes into the action.
How good is he? I love that he's going wide.
This
has
is how
experience.
You unlap yourself. This is good. Well, JB was one of those three racers that raced in that 1990 Nissan Sydney 500 all those years ago, back in 26 years ago.
He's not holding back. I love that how long he's been in the sport. Is you see him driving old F1 cars, the muscle car, this, and every single one, he is either full sideways, winning, or just having a red-hot go.
And Dom Story will be hating what he's seen right now. He split the two guys up, the battling for position.
Yeah, it really didn't help Dom out, did it?
It didn't.
No.
Here's the new model Hurricane. Manolius puts the car out of the way.
Giving Jake a bit of breathing space there.
Oh, JB doesn't really know which way he's going to go here. We push him around the corner. New, brand new 488 Ferrari. John Bow trying to unlap himself has actually caused a bit of damage to the right rear of the square Audi.
This is a bit of retro John Bow going on. Wow.
That is unbelievable. He hasn't lost
the bike. Past him.
Oh, no. Is that tyre going to hang on?
That's pretty disappointing for Jake, obviously. He driven faultlessly all day and from no fault of his own.
Oh, no, the tyre is going. It's chunking out. It's punctured. It's gone. They were on for a good result.
One lap to go.
Unbelievable.
Oh, the beginning of the last lap.
And he's fuming behind the steering wheel, and rightly so too.
Well, 20 years after the controversy of Dylan and Creville down there at that turn eight, Hairpin will write another little chapter. Unlapping himself, John Bow putting the blowtorch on the back of the old Audi and essentially causing that tyre to deflate. But it's time to focus our attention on this man because he has set the lap record here 26 years after his dad first drove an Australian Endurance Championship event at this track. It was the first ever race here, wasn't it?
It was, yeah.
November 1990, before the 500s came here. And this is going to be a pretty special moment for the Medici family. And it'll be a popular win in the paddock too, because, let's face it, everyone loves George.
Very lovable bloke. Down to earth, humble. Got time for everyone. So surely he's due for a massage now.
After this big stint at the end of the race. 5-second penalty coming their way, but they've got a 17-second lead all up. We started this race at 8:30 in the morning. We're ticking over 2.5 hours. Round two of the Australian Endurance Championship comes to an end. And it's a little bit of a surprise victory, if you ask me, for the Aston Martin. Great work. George and Andy. Matt Andy gives his son the thumbs up as he heads across the finish line.
A proud dad today, no question.
That is cool. He couldn't slow down too much to celebrate because he needed to keep a good lead over John Martin. Walkinshaw on the podium for the first time in the Australian Endurance Championship, at least in the modern day era. And we'll have to wait for third. Larry Perkins and Thomas Mazzera, it was, who got the win back then.
It was.
In a Commodore.
Serious combination.
Not bad. third today will go to Nathan Antunes and Greg Taylor.
I'm going to say they have the coolest looking car.
They do. A very solid drive from both those guys today. Yes. Particularly Nathan Antunes, who steers the Audi onto Mr. Jack Brabham straight. He was 37 seconds behind the front two guys and chalk up the podium spot here at Sydney Motorsport Park today.
Oh, is that Baird going slow to the finish as well?
It was. Just going to get to the line.
Now, I wonder what that's about. Maybe that's... Oh, the right front wheel popped off. At the finish line.
Wow.
So what on earth?
That you can see the thread and nut's still on fire, so potentially an upright failure.
And he got it to the checkered flag. Berto, take a bow.
That's called dragging it home.
Wow. He's off the lead lap as a result. And he still gets across the line in 17th, though. In 11th as a result. That's a good bag of points from him in the end. Right rear puncture for McConville.
So it's all happened in the last lap here. Can you believe it?
What on earth is going out there? They have come home in 19th. Watch the right front here, guys. This is what the Toyota needed to do at Le Mans this year. Know that you're in trouble. Wait for the leaders to go and finish the race and then cross the finish line. Because there was no way he was making another 3Ks out of this thing. Watch it just pop off here.
So when he turned across, yes. Oh.
10 metres after the finish line. It's like he actually went to turn left over towards the pit wall and then it came off. Unbelievable. Wow. What is it with endurance racing that just manages to bring out surprise after surprise?
And the potential safety car came after the race.
Yeah, exactly.
Thanks, guys.
Designed for 101 laps and then they stopped then.
We've done 202 consecutive laps in this championship without a safety car. Everyone take a bow. That's your top 10. Talbot and Foraker get home for 10th. Disappointment in the end. They deserve more. Baird sneaking home for P11. And the controversial finish there with Bow and Edwards. Nice work. He's just gone and parked it, if we can use a Brian Clawson term, at the end of this 101 lap big endurance journey. And they are going to be absolutely thrilled with bringing it home. Second position today will be the 911.
Hope he doesn't get run over here as he walks out.
How tall is he? You wouldn't think he fits in the Aston Martin.
He's not going to make his Aussie Racing Cars debut anytime soon, that's for sure. And it's an Audi in third, so three manufacturers pick up the top three. Nathan Antunes, very good across these endurance races.
2 hours and 37 minutes. We've got the race done safety car free here today at Sydney Motorsport Park. But there is your winner, George Medici, along with Matt Andy, his dad, chalking up the win.
Awesome stuff. And again, he looks like he's barely even been working out there. Four drivers underneath the lap record. And it is the Aston Martin that will hold on to that lap record at the end. So much drama at the end of that race. A few different drivers literally limping across the finish line with tyres deflating. Oh, that's nice. Adrian Burgess heading down there as well to congratulate the Walkinshaw boys.
Retro SBR suit. That's nice to see
cool.
too.
Oh, George Medici, mate, congratulations. We saw you embrace your dad. Must be a very special feeling.
Mate, that's a long day, but I've got to say, that pretty much tops it. I think family team, family drivers, and love it. I just love it.
And your daughter's here too.
Yeah, exactly. I think she's probably a bit too far away to be here right now, but yeah, became a dad 6 months ago and got the team together and Matt Stone and everyone's doing a great job, Aaron the engineer and my dad too, he bloody killed it. So it was
hey, you made it a bit more difficult for him though with that 5 second penalty.
Yeah, well, you've got to get a few excuses in for there. We've got to make him work a bit. We've got the lap record, so he made up for it.
Well done, guys. Great to see a family team doing a great job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very emotional Medici family down there and rightly so, collecting the win here today at Sydney Motorsport Park.